Oh.
Monday Night Raw, Chicago, Illinois, last night.
Oh, yeah.
CM Punk, the rumors. He was supposed to be back last night.
Where was he?
I'm glad he wasn't there, because if he was there, I would have had to come on here right now.
With a bald head.
For the next 2 hours, with a bald head and no hat. And
no hat.
The hat's on.
Although we got about the same amount of hair right now.
You got a haircut today. You're looking good today.
I try and do
You're
it.
Looking
I
good.
Don't know if everybody notices. I do a different look every week.
Yeah.
It's either a full beard and long hair, or short hair and a full beard, or just a goatee and long hair.
On purpose, or...
Yeah.
Why?
Just because it's funny. I was gonna leave.
I
was gonna leave just a. Nobody impressed. I think it's funny. I was gonna leave just a mustache.
Yeah.
And I forgot when I was shit. I'd already
like
hit
the, like
I,
the.
I already said whack, and I said, oh, fuck. And in my head, I'm like, shit. I was gonna leave a big.
Like
ass,
the '80s porn stash.
Yeah. Cody Rhodes with his mustache and all that. I was gonna leave a. And then I thought maybe I could do a Hitler mustache, but I had gone too far.
Too far in.
I was literally gonna leave the Hitler mustache.
You're all clean shaven this week, man. There's no gel in the hair.
You dare me to do the Hitler mustache next week? That's controversial, but I'll do it. Hey, Jordan did it.
Jordan?
Michael. For his Hanes commercial on the airplane. You remember he had the Hitler mustache?
No.
Big controversy at the time. Yeah.
Recently?
No, it was a couple weeks, several years ago. Five, seven, whatever years ago, but yeah.
I don't remember that.
He tried to pull off the Hitler mustache, yeah.
Well, you're all clean shaven tonight. Got
all
that.
Cleaned
got the
up.
Fresh dew.
No hat, though, because CM Punk... I don't know if you heard the rumors.
Oh, the rumors?
The rumors.
He's talking about the rumors.
The rumors about CM Punk didn't happen.
Man, I gotta tell. I mean, listen, we're gonna get into Monday Night Raw from last night. I was not a fan.
Me neither.
I was not a fan of Bob Raw last night. When you've got a bunny, a gator, and Los Matadores.
What was it?
The bull.
An alligator, a bull.
And the
a
bunny.
Bunny, yeah, all in one thing,
all
right?
All in one segment out there. And I put up on Facebook.
The bunny's
said,
getting over with me, though. I think he's funny.
When are we going to see, and it may be the pre-show at Hell in the Cell, but come on. When are we going to see
a triple threat match
between the bunny, the bull, and
Didn't even cross my mind until you just said it, but that's exactly what they're going to do.
WWE's
eventually.
Comedy. It may be on the pre-show.
Or a main event to plug the network. Tune into the network.
Something. You're going to see the bunny, the bull, and the alligator all feud and wrestle it out. You know what I mean?
Okay.
Looks like Justin Gabriel. Well, the bunny's been played by a couple different people, right?
Yeah. Zane Gabriel. Tyson Kidd was rumored at once.
Right. The bull we know, I don't remember his name, but the guy came over from Mexico.
Yeah, I don't know.
Little Lucha Libre type guy. And Hornswoggle was obviously the alligator from last night. But, man, we'll get into Monday Night Raw from last night. Kind of it's been busy on the websites as far as news is concerned, but not... very much breaking news. I mean,
A lot of breaking MMA news, but we covered most of that last week.
And we'll talk a little bit about UFC. I mean, you said that it was UFC's biggest pay-per-view in a long time.
For the diehard fans.
Yeah.
The main event sucked, obviously.
Yeah.
There were people leaving during the main event. The fight itself turned out to be okay. It was a quick second round submission. But, on paper, going into the show, nobody cared about that.
I had told you that, you know, it was a great card going in. But
very
the names
great.
On that show, I mean, it's not like when the casual fan looks
I
at
said
UFC.
Diehard.
The diehard.
Diehard
fans,
that's one of their favorite cards
absolutely.
In a long time. And
absolutely.
I looked today, there's two shows on Saturday. Both are one fight shows. There's 12 fights each show. You couldn't give up. You couldn't even name.
Really?
You couldn't
really?
Even name
right.
one person other than the two main eventers.
Coming up this Saturday.
This Saturday.
Yeah,
two
yeah,
shows.
Yeah.
And and then the next pay-per-view's got like a fight or two that's worth watching. And,
yeah.
and that's a pay-per-view.
Right.
So like it was really a throwback this past weekend to where every fight had somebody you at
right.
least knew. Like Patrick
yeah.
Cote
oh, yeah.
was in the
well,
prelims.
Manny Gamberian.
Gamberian was
Gamberian.
The first fight.
Was the first fight on the Facebook prelims, too.
On the, Fight Pass prelims. Yeah.
yeah.
And Dominic Cruz was on the prelims.
Yes.
I mean,
yeah.
it was that stacked.
So yeah.
And every fight turned out...
It's pretty good, man.
Every pay-per-view fight turned out great. The main event on the
not
prelims...
Not the main event. The main event of the pay-per-view
main event
was
a second round submission.
Yeah.
So it was quick, at least. You
yeah.
know.
Yeah. But it was a pretty good show. From
damn good
top
show.
To bottom
a lot
right
of controversy.
Now. Yeah.
The old Romero Tim Kennedy thing was total bullshit.
Yeah.
Conor McGregor's knockout, some people thought it was back of the head.
Oh, the Tim Kennedy fight was where the guy sat on the bench for like a minute longer.
Yeah, it was 28 seconds extra. And the controversy was everybody thought his corner was buying time. It was actually to those who didn't see it. Tim Kennedy, Yoel Romero, round one, they come out, right at the very end of the round, Tim Kennedy is fucking up Romero on the ground. Mm-hmm. If you would have given him three more seconds, would have been a knockout. TKO would have been over, but the bell rang.
It was close.
So you got to go to the next round, and Romero doesn't even know where the fuck he is. He's held to his corner, he's leaned against the cage, he's out.
Right.
So, you throw me off when you do that.
No, my bad.
Fucking, he's out on his stool, and he had a big cut from getting pounded on, so they're putting Vaseline on the cut, and somebody said, oh, that's too much, get rid of, you know, this and that, and so the big controversy was, well, he got an extra 30 seconds to recover, because long story short, as soon as the bell rang, he came out and immediately knocked out Tim Kennedy, wow, that's fucked up. He got a chance to clear the cobwebs and then go out and immediately knock him out.
Right.
Whereas he should, and backstage, did you hear about that? Backstage, Tim Kennedy confronted him.
Oh, did he?
Flipping out, cussing out.
Well, I heard that Kennedy's going to appeal the loss.
Yeah,
right?
they won't overturn it, though.
Yeah.
But, because they'll never admit when they're wrong.
Even the referee was kind of saying, let's go.
Big John McCarthy's first match back in Vegas in a long time.
He's a good ref, man. He's a good ref.
Great ref.
You know?
But the controversy was the corner buying time, and it turned out it was an official UFC doctor, not part of Romero's corner.
Oh, really? That was doing it? Okay.
Now, it's more involved than that. It would take forever to explain, but yeah, his corner did do a bunch of... They were pretending not to speak English when they were
talking. Right.
But like Dana White said, you don't need to speak English for somebody to be screaming in your face, get the fuck out of here!
Right. Get back in the cage.
To at least try to understand, alright, they're telling us like it's time to start the fight again, you know.
We'll talk about it a little bit more here as we get into things. The other big news is last night they announced, and I have...
Conor McGregor made Ric Flair look like a fucking bum.
Conor McGregor.
Did you watch the post-fight press conference?
I didn't.
He came out in his three-piece suit.
Did he?
Trunk ivory. I get truckloads of cash to kick people's ass. He is a fucking superstar, bro.
Let me tell you a story in the pro wrestling world that has a lot of people pissed off. A lot of emails today. Beyond Wrestling should be. A lot of emails today.
Right?
Yeah. Okay. A lot of emails today. A lot of tweets. A lot of Facebook messages. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
Last night on Raw, they announced that the WWE Network.
Oh, we're on a different page. I thought you were talking about the apology and all that.
Oh, we'll talk about that.
That's controversy too.
Yeah, but come on. They had that apology pre-written.
I almost did a spit take.
A week ago. That apology. Come on, man. When Big Show.
It's like this. They wrote the script and then said, all right, now write the apology.
Now write the apology that we're going to have to come out with tomorrow.
Yeah.
Knowing that because
people
the flag hit the ground.
Yeah.
He
yanked it down, right?
He yanked it down and it hit the ground. So, of course, whenever a flag hits the ground.
We're talking like everybody. Big Show yanked the Russian flag down on Raw.
We'll get into it when we run down Raw. But. Speaking of Raw last night, they announced that the WWE Network in the United Kingdom had been delayed for about another month.
Ah, that's right.
I think October 1st. I had so many tweets. I had emails left and right. People on my Facebook page saying the UK fans get fucked again. They screwed us over again. This, that,
UK
and the other
fans
thing.
Are passionate about their
really
wrestling.
Really passionate, man. Where all of these UK and we have a lot of people, a lot of them that listen
Tons.
To us tonight.
Tons.
I guess the idea with delaying the WWE Network in the UK is. They want to do something. similar to what they've done in Canada, and that leads us to a whole another story
to put it on actual TV as a channel, which was what they wanted to do in America originally,
right?
And they found that financially it wouldn't be feasible. They were only going to get so much subscription.
Right.
They said, well, let's just do it ourselves over the top digital.
Well, they did it in Canada.
And it worked like a son of a bitch.
It worked like a son of a bitch, but now they are involved in a lot of controversy up there where the Fight Network...
Well, they had contracts, too, with for their programming.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that, like, is in conflict with some of those, I believe.
Well, the Fight Network...
That's a separate thing, but I know.
The Fight Network feels like the WWE Network is coming in and their competition for the Fight Network.
They're
encroaching
on their territory.
Well, wait a minute. You know, we've got an exclusive deal with Rogers in Canada, which is the major cable company, like the Time Warner or the DirecTV In Demand.
Yes.
Exactly, up in Canada. So the Fight Network feels that WWE is invading their territory and saying, wait a minute, this isn't bad. And they kind of are, as the Fight Network
carries. The Fight Network is more boxing, MMA, kickboxing. It's not so much pro wrestling, is it?
No, it's not. It's more UFC and MMA.
In boxing, too.
In boxing.
They cover boxing.
In boxing.
And kickboxing, yeah.
But it's still the point of, you know, WWE's coming in.
I love the Fight Network. I download so much shit.
Yeah, they're coming in. So WWE wants to do something similar to that in the United Kingdom, where, sure, you're going to have it online, just like in Canada, right? Yeah, they can get it online, but they want to try to launch something through a major television provider in the United Kingdom. Is that going to happen? I think that's part of the reason for the delay, is give us another month to negotiate with these major TV networks overseas in the UK, and then if it doesn't happen, you guys will get it online come October 1st.
I think
everybody will be able to view it online. But in the meantime, let us...
And well, then all the complaints kind of point to the fact that it's going to work if they get a channel in the UK.
In the UK,
just like Canada, which Canadian fans are fucking real passionate about their wrestling. UK fans are too.
Right.
And I think it might even be because it's in person. Mm-hmm. It's so rare for them to get this. Like, for Americans, we can go watch them live and in person and this and that.
A lot of events all over the place.
Yeah, so it's not as... It's not as...
Widespread?
No, it's not as, like, major. I can't think of the right word.
Okay.
It's basically, when you get to Canada and the UK, the only way you can see it is on TV. You can't go see it live except for once or twice.
Unless you drive a couple hundred miles to the very few indie shows that they have.
No, I'm talking about the main people, the main stars.
Right.
The only chance you get to see these larger-than-life stars, that's what I'm looking for. They're not larger-than-life to us in America because we can go fucking see them, you know, in all these different towns.
We can drive
every
right,
week
they're
in one of
city.
Our towns.
Right,
so
right.
To our country, it's like, yeah, they're the wrestling and this and that.
Whereas
but,
in the UK and Canada, WWE and TNA only come overseas once
so
or twice
often,
a year.
Yeah.
So,
well, Canada, they hit everyone, you know.
Canada's more often than the UK.
Yeah.
Right.
But still not as frequently, obviously, as the States.
As the United States, right.
So to them, it's like, yeah, the only way they have access to this world is through TV or pay-per-view or the internet.
Right.
So, yeah, if they give you a full 24/7 channel of you know, obviously they're going to love it.
Right.
Whereas in America, it's like, well, fuck that. I mean, we get it for free on TV every week.
We get to view it all over the
arena every 2 months and see them, you know.
So, anyways, but it looks like October 1st, and in the meantime, they're going to be working on a television deal.
Yeah, real quick, to Winter's Lair, like you had touched. I'm not talking about indie wrestling. I'm talking about if you want to see John Cena.
The top names, John Cena.
If you want to see CM Punk, or whoever is the big names, Dean Ambrose, Roman Reigns. If you want to see the big name wrestling stars, you have to turn your TV on. You can't just go to the arena and
big
see
name,
them.
Big name stars.
Except every once in a while.
Speaking of television deals and, you know, television deals and TV, pay-per-views and things of that nature, Jeff Jarrett's Global Force
That's
Wrestling. Looks like they're going to hold their first ever pay-per-view event.
It's kind of confusing to me. Maybe you can explain it.
In January of 2015.
January 4th, the big Tokyo Dome
January
show.
January 4th, okay.
It's their annual show. It's kind of like their WrestleMania in New Japan. Their big Tokyo Dome show. It's always on January 4th.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's always January 4th. I know it's always in the first
week. It's always in January.
Always first week of January. Or always early January. I think it's actually January 4th every single year.
Okay.
But it's their big fucking show, and they're going to, I guess, co-promote, kind of like Wrestle 1 and TNA is doing with Bound for Glory.
That's what it looks like.
But it's
going to
be branded in America as GFW.
As GFW.
Force.
Correct.
Yeah.
Correct. And it's kind of, I mean, listen, TNA
exactly
is
what TNA
teaming
and Wrestle 1's doing, right?
With New Japan Pro Wrestling as well. Wrestle 1, my bad.
Yeah.
Not Jeff Jarrett is going to team. It's the same concept that TNA is doing for Bound for Glory with Wrestle 1.
Yeah.
Where TNA is teaming
similar
with Wrestle 1.
Yeah.
Very similar concepts. Where, so you've got TNA and Wrestle 1, they're going to co-promote, you're going to have Bound for Glory. It's basically one Wrestle One guy against one TNA guy. Yeah. Tag team matches, like, two Wrestle One guys versus
like the
two
Invasion
TNA
in WWF when it was a WWF, the Invasion pay per view. Every match was WWF versus WCW. WWF
right.
versus WWF.
Right. And a lot of people were wondering going in, because TNA was taping television so far in advance, how are they going to do this without the spoilers leaking out? And then it comes out yesterday that it really doesn't matter, because it's basically Wrestle One versus TNA, despite who
the only title
are.
That I saw was the X title on the line. There's no TNA World title.
No, the main TNA title changed hands. Bobby Lashley.
No, no,
not
no. That's a spoiler. But I'm talking about the Bound for Glory card. I didn't see a TNA Bound for Glory or a TNA World title match.
I think all the shows were taped. Any title changes were taped after Bound for Glory.
It's not. I'm asking the Bound for Glory as far as title matches on the Bound for Glory lineup.
Oh, there's not.
The X title is on the line. That's okay. The only one I saw, but your biggest show of the year, and you've only got your cruiserweight title, quote-unquote.
You know what? I think, and the reports have said, and this seems fairly obvious, is that TNA is basically... We know that TNA Bound for Glory is our WrestleMania show every year, right?
Yeah.
Right now, they are so focused on getting a new television deal, as they need a TV deal to survive. So Bound for Glory kind of takes a back seat right now.
Is that Dixie Carter is basically promising the talent. Didn't she hold a big meeting or send a big
She held a meeting.
January 7th, right?
In Bethlehem, Pennsylvania. That said, was it January 7th? Was that the official date?
She says January 7th we will have a TV deal by January 7th, which is kind of 3 days away from
Well,
GW.
January 7th, TNA's Spike TV deal runs through 2014. So January 7th is the first day.
It's the first Wednesday.
Exactly.
Which is now where they air would be without a TV.
It's the first
so
Wednesday.
She's saying, all right, the very first week where we are not on Spike TV, we will be on something else.
We will be somewhere else.
There's talk of WGN.
That seems to be the front runner.
Velocity. There's some names, and there's two other networks that we don't know the names of.
WGN seems to be the front runner.
I hear the most.
I think that seems to be the front runner, which is a pretty major network.
We get it.
Do we get it?
Sure. I think pretty much, almost everybody who has cable gets it.
A lot of people get it. It's not like WGN is a small network. I mean, yes, it's a step down from Spike TV.
Not that much.
But not that much.
It's not as well known as Spike TV.
Right.
It's in as many, not as many homes, I think, but it's very damn close. I think.
It's not a bad television deal for TNA. It is a step down from Spike TV, but like Boone said, it's not all that far down. But Spike TV is a much more known name.
How much does that help their ratings? Like, I think there are a million fans that watch their TV show. If they're able to switch to a different channel and watch it, they will.
Well, and
look, it's not like Spike TV built them up by promoting TNA all the time. They barely ever fucking mention it.
Look what TNA's been through as well. They've been on Thursday nights. They recently went to Wednesday night. Those first couple of weeks, they were down at, a 0.6 or a 0.7 rating. Now that they've been on Wednesday for the last couple of weeks, they're at about a 0.8 rating.
They hit a 1 million mark, 1 or 2
weeks, I think. So they're back. They're diehard fans.
Yeah, people get into routines. They like us with Monday. It's fucking grained in our head. Monday, 8 o'clock. It used to be Monday, 9 o'clock.
8 o'clock,
yeah.
Right.
So
right.
When they switched to TNN, it took a little...
Right.
They switched from 9 p.m. to 8 p.m. when it was 2 hours to 3 hours. There's patterns that you get into, and then you have to become used to a new pattern. But I think that the people that watch Impact on Spike TV it's been proven.
They're going to find him.
Those million people ain't going nowhere. Roughly that around about 800 to a million, 800,000 to a million people are big enough fans that they will watch that
show. They will flip through and find them wherever they are.
Even now, on every week on the same station, Spike TV, every week.
Yeah.
The show can be as awful as fucking all hell.
They're still tuning in.
They're still watching. So I think they're passionate enough about I want to watch another wrestling show other than WWE, that if it's available to them on their TV, they'll watch it.
And WWE's got that same loyal, diehard fan
base.
About
3 million.
A lot more than 1 million. It's like triple that. Exactly. It's about 3 million.
And their conversion rate's a lot better. They can take.
Yeah.
Well, actually, if you really break it down, 3 million, and then you get 200,000 people buying the pay per view, and then TNA gets 1 million, and they've got 10,000. So, you know, 10,000.
Right. 10,000 pay per view people 10% ordering.
10%. You know, pretty much even.
All right. So listen, we gave you a lot of wrestling talk. Now let's talk a little bit about the NFL. Right? Oh, fantasy football. I started out. We haven't talked
about
it
because
we missed 2 weeks. Pretty much the opening 2 weeks of NFL. I mean, we were here. This was week four. We missed the first two opening weeks. We weren't here. Last week, my Buffalo Bills, we suffered a tough loss to the San Diego Chargers. This week, we went on. We
lost
came
to
into Houston, Texas. We lost to the Texans. Ooh, we gave
game.
It a good fight. We were on the final drive. We were driving the field.
One score game all the way to the
end. EJ Manuel throws an interception. The problem I have is Buffalo's defense, awesome. They're great. Buffalo's defense is one of the best defenses in the entire NFL. Our offense is pretty fucking good. My problem that I have is EJ Manuel. And listen, the dude's a rookie quarterback.
Yeah,
I know he's been here.
Turnovers.
I know he's been here for 2 or 3 years. EJ's been in the league. But a star isn't born. Very rarely. I mean, RG3 came in. Now that he's injured, we don't know, you know, what he really is. Well,
Stafford came in, and he's been killing it.
Stafford came in, and he did his thing. Andrew Luck came in for the Colts. He did his thing. EJ Manuel is not there just yet, and he's made a lot of mistakes, and that's our problem. Buffalo's main problem is EJ Manuel. I think the offense is pretty fucking good. I think the defense is good. Everything's good. EJ just needs work. Now, with that being said, we're 2-2. It's not bad. We're not off to a horrible start.
Unlike you in fantasy football.
Fantasy football, good transition. That's where I was going.
Yeah. What's your record?
I'm in two different leagues, okay, in fantasy football. I'm in the WZR League, and I'm in Dan's League over there.
Yes.
I started off 0-3 in Dan's League. I started off 0-3. In the WZR League. Not a good start. No wins.
Not nothing.
This week, in the WZR League, the last I checked, I think,
I checked
last night, I didn't check today, but I think I won in the WZR League. I think. And I had a pretty fucking low score. But I think
right
I beat...
Here. We got fast Wi-Fi.
Do you have it bookmarked?
Yeah, here. I'll get it.
All right, get it up. So anyways, I think, I'm getting you a browser. I think, I won in the WZR League. Now, in Dan's League, over there...
We're checking WZR League.
So, over in Dan's League, last night, I go and I check, and the game's over between the Patriots and the Kansas City Chiefs, right? I check the score of the guy I'm playing. It's 142-142. How often does that happen? That you get a
oh, that's
tie
right, you tied up.
Game,
I forgot
right?
about that. Yeah.
So I texted Dan. I said, "Yo, what's the deal here, man?" I said, "We are tied up. The week is over." He says, "Check your. Oh, what do we? I won.
You won. All right. Oh God, you guys both did shit.
We did terrible. I told you we had a low score.
I doubled my fucking guy. I played.
Yeah, you did great this week. Huh? But so I wound up tying this guy over in Dan's League, and I said to Dan, I said, "What's the deal, man? What happens?" He says, "You go to your bench players, you know, like
I remember this whole conversation.
My bench versus his bench to find out who wins, and my bench beat his. So I got a win in the WZR League. I got a win in Dan's League. I'm 1-3.
So two out of your three things you need.
Now do your thing. Tell us
about
your week.
That's
all
my
right?
setup. That's my setup.
I'm 1-4 in both, or 1-3 in both leagues.
That's my segue.
Okay.
There's three things we care about each week with football.
Yes, sir.
Our two fantasy leagues and our home team.
Absolutely.
You're the Bills on the line.
Yes, sir.
So you got two out of the three because the Bills lost. I got two out of the three. I won in the WZR League.
All right.
Doubled the guy I played. Yes, 164 sir. Versus 164 points for me, 81 for
Martin.
Chris Dan's
team.
Baby. All right. So I win that one. The Lions beat the Jets.
Yes, sir.
So that improves that your Bills are what, 2-2?
2-2.
Lions are 3-1.
I thought you were 2-2.
3-1.
All right.
I won in the WZR League where I'm 2-2.
Okay.
Lost in Dan's League in a fucking close one.
Are you 1-3 or 2-2
over there? I'm 1-3 in Dan's league right now. And I was playing an undefeated 3-0 guy, and I was this fucking close to beating him Peyton benched, with a couple of my main guys were benched, and I had to go out and make trades and this and that. And I
where
picked the perfect guys, but my defense put up 0 fucking points.
Yeah, you know what? This was the week where the buys
my
started.
My kicker put up like 2. Those two things, if they would have been normal, 10, 5,
but
I would
you know won. What? It's a good thing to get your bye weeks out of the way, because I know Peyton had a bye. Like,
and I've got Peyton in both leagues.
I know.
So that hurt. Yeah. But Eli Manning.
How about Calvin Johnson?
Shit the bed. But Eli Manning filled in for me on one league, and then Tony Romo the other. I know Eli killed it. How did Tony Romo do? I don't even know. I know the Cowboys won.
Tony did good, man. Tony had a really good game.
Yeah, I know the Cowboys defense did great.
Right. No, Tony had a really good game.
But okay, so
Calvin Johnson shit the bed. I mean, this guy over here, he was saying, Calvin Johnson, I'm picking him number one.
No, I didn't.
Last year.
Yeah.
Last year.
When I had no shit about fantasy football.
Absolutely.
And he did good last year,
I said,
by the way.
He did great last year.
Yeah, this year, not so much.
This year, well, the first.
He did all right. Not great.
But this week, I think in the WZR League, he put up like 1 point.
Well, it was probably 1.2. Because last time I checked, he had one catch for 12 yards. That was it.
It was.
Maybe he got another one.
No, I think that was about it.
Is that it?
I think that was about it, man.
But there was some fucking Tate, or what was his name?
Golden Tate, that's my boy.
That motherfucker got like 140 yards.
I got him on WZR. I got him in Dan's league. I got him in Dan's league.
He did great.
He kills it, man. So
you got Stafford, right?
You got Antonio Brown.
In both leagues.
You sure you don't want to trade?
In both leagues.
I'll trade you for Antonio Brown.
He is my fucking ace.
I give you anybody you want for Antonio Brown. I give you anybody you want for Antonio Brown. Come on.
He's the reason I'm hanging in there with anybody I play. I'm in the game.
Boone.
Won't do it, bro.
Antonio Brown?
Nope. As I was saying, though, you
I'm
got
to work on him throughout the
he's been trying for 2 weeks,
me Antonio.
I'm not even going to hear it. I'm not trading
Antonio Brown.
You're going to
trade Antonio Brown.
Hey, give me your best player. I'll give you somebody else.
I'll give you two players for Antonio.
I don't
want
two
can't
players.
Do that anyways. But,
no, I was saying, you got Stafford, right? At least in one league. You got him in both?
Stafford's iffy. I got him in one league.
He's
I got
doing good this year.
I got Brady in the other league. I'm thinking Brady.
Yeah,
last
well, Flacco
night.
Flacco does good, and you got Flacco on the bench.
Yes.
I'd switch it. As big of a name as Tom Brady is, he ain't doing this year.
Tom Brady, last night, Monday Night Football, Tom Brady benched Bill Belichick, and Tom Brady came out.
That? Tom Brady,
Tom Brady came out. And a lot
and,
of people.
And what, real quick, what's funny is, do you remember how he got started? They had Drew Bledsoe.
Oh, that's right.
And
that's
Bledsoe
right.
got
yeah.
either benched or injured or something, and they put this new guy, Tom Brady, in, and fucking Tom Brady went nuts.
Tom Brady, and I put it up on Facebook
for
last
the young
night.
Guys out there, Drew Bledsoe was a
Drew
fucking
Bledsoe
beast.
Was awesome back in the day.
Yeah.
But, so, I put it up on Facebook last night. I said, Tom Brady got benched, right? And everybody replied, they said, no. The Patriots were losing so badly that they took Tom Brady and the rest of the guys out,
sure
right?
Lost.
Wait a minute.
Bullshit.
So, they took everybody out. No. Tom Brady, in the post presser last night, said that I was the first guy taken out of the game. Bill Belichick said to me, yo, it's time for you. Sit on the sidelines. The starters were still in at that point. The backup quarterback comes in. The starters are still in. Tom Brady was on the bench. Tom Brady said, you know what? I was just having a bad game. I was playing bad. It was my fault. And that's not to say that next week they're not going to have Tom Brady start. Of course, Brady's going to go back out there and start next week.
Who's their backup?
But I don't even know his name. I couldn't tell you. I don't know, because Raw was over. Raw ended last night. Mm-hmm. I switched over to the NFL game, and there was only like 4 or 5 minutes left in the game. And by that point, it was a blowout, so I wasn't really paying much attention. I was doing the work. But, so Tom Brady got benched, and I'm thinking, you may be right. It may be time.
Flacco's great.
It may be time to start Flacco
over
Brady.
Flacco puts up numbers. Like, the Ravens' offense isn't the great, or at least the last time I used to follow the Ravens. Their defense was always the shit. Their offense was always in. But Flacco would always put up numbers. Kind of like the Lions.
Yeah.
Lions defense. By the way, and Dominican Sue says he's done with the Lions after this year.
Yeah. I heard that.
Although he does get us a lot of fucking trouble with all the
he's kind of a dickhead, though. He stomps on people's faces
I think he's been fined more than anybody or whatever. But fucking, yeah. So, but yeah, the Lions defense was always strong. Offense, But Stafford would put up numbers.
Stafford, Calvin Johnson, Golden Tate's out there now.
Now that they've got Joyc Bell, Reggie Bush,
Pettigrew, tight end.
Pettigrew, right. Tate, right. And obviously Megatron.
You've got a good team this year.
We're building up a fucking franchise.
What,
you give us two or 3 years?
Bills
two?
We've got Chandler out there.
EJ Manuel on this, though.
Yeah,
Matthew Stafford,
I know.
You can build a team around.
Absolutely.
You can build a whole offense around that guy.
We've got Chandler out there.
When I was a kid, you had to rely on the run with Barry Sanders.
Yeah.
We had all these different quarterbacks come through. None of them really worked. But Barry was reliable, so they'd be a ground team.
We've got a...
Now you can build your offense around the pass and mix it up with the run because you got Joyc Bell and Reggie Bush splitting carries. And they both get, produced.
Right. And Buffalo is another young team.
But that was what I was going to say. Who's your guys' running back?
Our running back, we split it between C.J. Spiller and Freddie Jackson.
Fred Jackson, I've got Fred Jackson.
And then our wide receivers
Who's the guy with the fucking dreads, the braids?
Sammy Watkins.
That guy's a new guy, he is
a beast.
But that was my point. You guys got these great running backs, these great receivers, and an awesome defense, but I don't like E.J. Manuel being the captain of the team.
That's the problem.
I think you need a better quarterback.
That's the problem, bro.
Is there anybody coming up in college that you can draft? We've got
Scott Chandler as the tight end, right?
Yeah.
We've got David Nelson, who's a nasty wide receiver. We've got Sammy Watkins, nasty wide receiver. We've got C.J. Spiller. We've got Freddie Jackson as running back.
Both are all awesome.
Yeah. So that's our offense, right? We've got Mario Williams on defense. One of the best, probably the top defensive guy. Although, what's his name? J.J. Watt from the Houston Texans is nasty. Nasty defensive player. But, Manuel
got benched? The Bills benched Manuel?
Manuel didn't get benched.
J.J. Watt killed Manuel.
No, Manuel didn't get benched. He was the one that, on the final drive down the field this past Sunday, he threw a pick, and that ended the game. But that was E.J. that threw that pick. He didn't get benched. But our offense is great, dude. It's just E.J. is the problem.
Your
team, you've got Golden Tate, Calvin Johnson, Brandon Pettigrew, Matt Stafford at QB,
Reggie Bush, Bell
as well. Dude, you've got, I'm telling you, we're going to be good, man.
We each got great teams.
All right.
I think you guys need a better quarterback.
Absolutely.
Let me put it this way. You guys can do some shit with Manuel.
Right.
If you got a better quarterback, you guys would be building a franchise.
I agree. It could
be like the old days when I was a kid, and it was the Bills losing in the Super Bowl every year.
Fuck you,
Barry Sanders and Thurman Thomas. You guys had Thurman Thomas.
Yeah.
They even went to college
together. Bruce Smith. Thurman Thomas. Jim Kelly.
We had Barry Sanders. And those motherfuckers. We had Chris Spielman on defense. Yeah, we had,
the
fuck was that other guy's name? I don't know. But we had a great team. Just no quarterbacks, no receivers. Mm. And then we had, what's his fucking name? Henry Moore. Oh, God. What is his name? That's going to bug the shit out of me.
I don't know.
Homer, he was breaking Jerry Rice's records. Herman Moore was a beast, bro. He was like our Chris Calvin Johnson of the day.
Both of our teams are young, and we are up-and-comers. So,
yeah.
EJ needs to...
I say 2 or 3 years from now, the Lions and Bills will be looked at way differently than they are now.
I agree 100%. 100%. All right, so here we go. Let's move on. We'll move on to pro wrestling.
We'll get back.
I'm going to do that right now.
All right.
So we started out with wrestling. We did a little NFL off-topic. Now we're getting back into wrestling for the rest of the show. We got about 20 minutes to run down Monday Night Raw from last night. That's about all we're going to need, to be honest with you, because it was not a good show. One more thing before we move on to the NFL.
Yes, to the WWE.
Sure you don't want to trade Antonio
Brown? Positive. Did you hear about the rumors?
Rumors?
We'll talk about that in a second. We'll talk about that in a second.
Rumors?
Oh, we got rumors for you.
We've got some rumors.
Yeah.
All right. The official website of WZR TV Tuesdays. WZRonline.com. Oh. We're on Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube as well. Go to Facebook.com/WZR Army, YouTube.com/WZR Archive, and we're on Twitter as well. WZRonline.com, top navigation bar, drop down menu. It's got all the links to Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube. Social media tab, WZRonline.com, the official home of WZR TV Tuesdays. Woo! So check it out, WZRonline.com. We've got all the news and the rumors. Live chat room on and in progress tonight. WZRonline.com/chat. WZRonline.com/chat. Get in there. Lots and lots of people in there, as always, tonight. Monday Night Raw.
What'd you think,
from
man?
From last night, top to bottom. What did I think?
Don't
what
be
did
shy.
You think?
I thought it fucking blew
it
shit.
It sucked. It was
I put it this way.
Terrible, man.
The opening was it, but Heyman was awesome as always.
Yes.
And I swear I'm not just saying that because it's the internet thing to do to say, oh, Heyman's always awesome. Yeah. He is always awesome. I'm sorry.
He's the best thing on Raw.
And Dean Ambrose is pretty fucking good, too.
Dean Ambrose
Cena,
is...
nobody eats off Dean Ambrose's plate. Not even you, John Cena. Dean Ambrose, what did he say last week? John, don't give me a reason not to like you, John.
Yeah.
He got some great fucking things, man.
That was good. From day one, and I don't know if... Maybe I'm wrong on this, but when we had all three members of the Shield,
yeah.
when they came in, I had always said... That I think Dean Ambrose.
Yeah.
I think Dean Ambrose. I could have sworn that when the Shield debuted and everybody started cutting promos, you said that you thought that the star coming out of the group was going to be Seth Rollins.
Oh my God! I was always the one that said I loved Seth Rollins, but I'm afraid to death when they break the group up because he's going to be the one.
Then he may get lost. All right, that's where I'm confused.
But I'll say now that they've broken the group up, they seem to be giving him... I mean, maybe because out of necessity, they don't have a deep enough roster, and they need guys like him that can work their asses off and can talk a little bit.
Yeah.
So they kind of, by default, have to put him in a top spot, but he's delivering.
My feeling is, when they broke up the Shield, I think they did the pecking order, right? And Roman Reigns was going to be the star. He was going to go on to WrestleMania, but it was going to take some time with the promos. But it was kind of a toss-up between Seth Rollins and Dean Ambrose.
And
I think they felt that Seth Rollins had a slight edge over Dean Ambrose, and I feel like that's the reason that they put Rollins with the Authority, as they were going to push him hardcore, put him with Triple H, Stephanie McMahon, Kane, Randy Orton.
My theory.
And Dean Ambrose was kind of... And my feeling is Dean Ambrose has stepped up to the plate in this Ambrose-Rollins feud, and I think now... I think Ambrose has got the edge on Rollins. I think if I were to rank them, I would say Dean Ambrose is number one, Roman Reigns is number two, and Seth Rollins is number three. As far as what they're going to do, I mean, Roman Reigns has got the big guy look, and you know that they're going to push
him. No matter what, he's going to make it because they're going to make sure he makes it.
Basically, let's take it down to Dean Ambrose and Seth Rollins.
Yeah.
Dean Ambrose.
I'm trying to keep in mind 2 points I'm going to make.
Dean Ambrose is
never ending here.
Dean Ambrose is above Seth Rollins.
Dean Ambrose is above Seth Rollins as far as
go ahead.
Who's better or who's being pushed more?
As far as who is better on the microphone, maybe not in-ring wise. They're about the same in-ring wise.
I'll give Rollins the edge in the ring.
But better on the microphone?
But they're different. They're different styles. Like Ambrose is crazy. Rollins is more of a high flyer.
They're different.
I was going to disagree and say that when they first broke up the group, it wasn't that they thought Rollins was going to be better than Ambrose. I think they thought Ambrose can make it no matter what. He can talk his ass off. He's the new Roddy Piper, this and that. Roman Reigns has the look. He's going to get over because we're going to fucking force feed him down everybody's throat.
Absolutely.
Not so much force feed him because people dig him and shit. So
right.
It's not like, oh, God, him again like Batista.
Right.
But with Rollins, I think they were worried that he was going to have trouble making it on his own.
Mm-hmm.
So let's put him with Triple H.
Let's
put him with Reigns. Let's put him and make him feel big by association. Whereas Ambrose didn't need that. He can make it on his own. Reigns don't need that. He can make it on his own. Rollins on his own. As a babyface on his own.
I will backtrack on what I just said and agree with that.
The obvious choice when they broke him up to pick the guy to be the heel obviously would have been Ambrose.
Yeah.
Out of the three, who feels like a heel?
Ambrose much
when they were together. Now that we've seen them in their individual characters, Rollins feels like a heel because he is a heel.
Right.
Whereas Ambrose isn't. But when they were a group, Ambrose had that edge to where if you were to pick one of those three to be a heel, you'd pick Ambrose. But I think the reason they did it the way they did it was because they needed Rollins that little support cast around them.
I'll backtrack on what I just said, where they were worried about Rollins and they put him with the Authority in Triple H, Stephanie McMahon, to have a group or people behind him.
Just by association, he feels bigger because of who he's running with.
You sold me.
There you go.
You're right. Reigns, like you said, with the look. I mean,
he looks like a star. He's got those spots, the running boot to the face on the apron, the Superman punch, the spear.
Right.
He looks like a star.
He looks like a big star.
And he's the big guy of the group, so obviously they like big guys. So he's going to be the guy no matter what.
You're right. All right, so Monday Night Raw opened with...
I'm always right.
Now listen.
Always right.
Here's the deal.
Yes.
We're in Chicago, Illinois.
No, we're in Albany, New York.
Last night.
They were in Chicago.
Monday Night Raw. Yes. They were in Chicago, Illinois for Monday Night Raw. Of course, you guys know Chicago.
Did you hear the rumors?
It's no... The rumors? Talking about rumors. No. Chicago.
Stephanie actually addressed it.
She
in
did.
Interview.
She
yeah.
did. Right here.
I mean, in a diplomatic way, but... No. A TV appearance before Raw. Remember?
No. WGN?
What about you guys? Yeah, it was a WGN show, no less.
Yeah.
She was asked, what are the chances of a reconciliation, was the key word,
right,
between CM Punk, and she gave, like, the politically correct,
you never know.
Anything's possible.
Anything, never say never,
so,
you know?
Yeah. She didn't dodge the question, but she didn't tease anything or hint at anything.
But they were in Chicago, Illinois last night, right? And you know how a lot of times...
What do you think
Chicago,
of that crowd?
What you think about the rumors? No.
The crowd didn't seem as high as the Chicago crowd. I wouldn't say they sucked.
They didn't suck.
They were loud for Ziggler and the people they liked and stuff, you know.
There was something missing. And I think... Did I spit?
No.
My bad. I think the opening segment where Stephanie McMahon came out and straight up addressed CM Punk as being a quitter.
Yeah.
I think...
Took it the wind out of their sails.
Kind of killed him.
I think the reason, if we're comparing it to the
last
time...
it was a terrible show.
Yeah, that too. But if we're comparing it to the last time they were in Chicago, that's not fair because it was fresh off the Punk quitting thing.
Sure.
And it was still believable that it was a work and that this is when he returns and reveals that it was a work.
Right.
Especially because of the way he got famous with the pipe bomb and all that. He was supposedly on the way out. And then, oh, no, he's not, you know.
And there were rumors going into that week that maybe...
A lot of rumors. And there was the hijack Raw thing and Daniel Bryan.
Yeah.
And that all was that was all fresh. So
that's
why that crowd seemed hotter because they were expecting Punk. And they started the show off with Punk's theme and Heyman came out and did a big thing about Punk.
But Chicago's always a hot crowd.
No,
before
and
the
I think
CM Punk
they were hot in spots last night, but they were not as hot as I was expecting.
Not at all.
I thought they were going to be like, I thought it was going to be a great show, even if it was a bad show.
Yeah.
Because you know how, if it's a bad show, I don't want to say if it's a bad show, they can make it a good show just by being loud and boisterous, but if it's a decent show, they can make it a good show.
Right.
I was thinking that was going to happen last night. It was going to be a show, but the crowd's going to be so awesome that it's going to feel great.
Right.
And that didn't happen.
Well, and part of the reason for that is alligators and bunnies and...
And rumors.
And rumors.
No, I'm just
talking about them rumors.
Yeah.
But I thought it was interesting, as a lot of times when Raw goes live right in Chicago, the show will open up and the crowd will already... Be chanting CM Punk.
Yeah.
So they aired this long video package to open Raw. Dean Ambrose, Seth Rollins, what's happened the last couple of weeks, what happened last week on Raw. This long video
I wonder if
package.
Anybody was there, because maybe sometimes they go and Raw's going live in 5, 4,
and everybody starts going, CM Punk,
and they've got the crowd muted while they play this super long video package.
Right.
You got the entrances, so by the time
it's over, they're done.
Yeah. But they got started up as soon as the music was done and Stephanie was on the mic, but she killed him with her.
That's what I was
She
thinking.
Had a, just the way they had a, this is what we're doing with Big Show and Rusev, now write the apology as well for tomorrow.
Right.
I think
this
as soon as we do
here,
the opening segment, now write Stephanie's just in case promo if they chant CM Punk.
I agree.
She had that like fucking
ready for it.
She was ready for it. You know?
So the Authority opens up Monday Night Raw, obviously. That's what we've been talking about here. They come out to the ring and they immediately start with the CM Punk chants before she can pretty much get a word out,
right on her. And that's what I thought was going to happen all night, but it didn't.
She says, you know what, kind of like, I know, she didn't specifically mention CM Punk, but she said, you know what, the guy that you're cheering for, you're just like him. You're a bunch of quitters. Everybody in Chicago is a bunch of quitters, you know? If you don't like what's going on at your job, you walk out and you quit.
Yeah.
Clearly a reference to CM Punk shooting at the hip, right?
That was a shot at Punk. But then she transitioned back to storyline.
Then
if you're not a quitter, you're a thief. You steal.
Exactly.
Just like Dean Ambrose stole
did
the
on briefcase. SmackDown.
Yeah.
On SmackDown.
So she brought it back.
So she brings it back, and eventually, Paul Heyman interrupts here.
Yeah.
Right? Paul Heyman comes out and says he wants to...
Well, there was a key word, because she had said... oh, disrespect.
Will not be tolerated.
And that's when Heyman came out and said, just so you know, my client
Brock
felt
Lesnar.
Disrespected because it was him that Seth Rollins hit the curb stomp on. It was him that,
You heard me in my room. You know, Paul Heyman comes out, right? And he always says, ladies and gentlemen, tell him.
Me too, I clap.
He is awesome, dude. He is the highlight of Raw every single freaking week, man. So he goes on about Brock Lesnar, and like you said,
that's the only guy that can talk. I mean, as far as like a really entertaining part, like Triple H and Stephanie can talk.
Right.
Dean Ambrose can talk a little bit. Seth Rollins can talk a little bit. Although he was stymied. He was stymied when they CM Punk chanted his ass, because he just kind of had, he had nothing. He just kind of put his head down and let him chant it.
Rollins came out after Heyman, right? Rollins comes out after
Heyman. I think he was already in there, no? Maybe he did.
He comes out after
Rollins. You're right, he did. Because I thought he was going to stand in there, because he said, well, Heyman, I thought you would understand.
Yeah, it was Triple H and Steph at first. So Rollins winds up coming at, and basically the whole gist of this thing is, listen, you stole my briefcase, I want it back.
Yeah.
Give it to me tonight.
Well, he addressed Heyman at first, because Heyman said, that he just, that Rollins disrespected.
He said he respected him.
And he said, no, I thought you of all people understand, I saw an opportunity, I took it, this and that. It was basically the gist. I mean, I thought you would have more to add, because you're over there reading.
No, he said that he respected Paul Heyman.
Yeah.
He respected Heyman, due to the fact that...
Oh, yeah, and he said he did everything on his own. Don't blame them. I saw an opportunity. I took it,
Right, right. So...
And he apologized to Brock.
He apologized to Brock, and he says that I'm sorry to you as
well. And Heyman said, but never do it again.
Never do it again.
Otherwise, you're not going to be apologizing to me.
You'll be apologizing to Brock. And then all of a sudden, on the Titantron, you hear... and Dean Ambrose pops up. This is where Ambrose comes in. And he basically, the gist of it is, listen, you want your briefcase? Come get it.
Yeah.
I'm right here. And
this where
Triple
he said he got the concession stand? That was later?
That was later in the night.
Okay.
So Triple H looks at Rollins and says, fuck it, let's go get it.
And Ambrose has that, who cares?
Whatever.
Who gives a fuck? God, like last week when he came back after being on Raw, he says,
right.
And they tried to stomp my head in the cinder blocks. And he says,
right.
Pretty cool, actually.
So they go back. They go get. They go back to get the briefcase. Right. They head to the back. They're looking for that briefcase. Eventually, when they come back from the commercial break,
they do point out before all of this that it doesn't matter if he has the briefcase or not. He can still cash in his contract whenever the hell he wants. Just because you have the briefcase
doesn't mean
you can stop him from cashing in his contract.
All right. So we come back from the commercial break, and we've got Jamie Noble, who I recognized right off the bat.
Joey Mercury was
Joey Mercury. Used to have long hair.
Well, he shaved it.
Long
when
hair.
Part of the Straight Edge Society.
I don't remember.
Yeah, when remember Punk's thing was he even shaved a Diva's hair off.
It was CM Punk and then
Gallows,
Serena Deeb.
Serena was the one he shaved the
head
off. Yeah, and Joey Mercury, remember, because he bought his house.
Joey was the other one.
He bought his house for him and stuff.
Right.
Yeah.
I mean, he was completely bald.
He was
recognized.
Yeah.
I didn't recognize.
Well,
you
should have, because you watched the Punk documentary where they told the story of him becoming a drug addict, getting fired.
No, but he looked different than that.
No, he was bald in the documentary.
He had a shaved head, but he wasn't bald.
He was
this is like a shiny,
clean shaven bald in the documentary.
Bald.
I just watched it the other day because I tuned into the network. I actually have the network now.
Yeah.
They were going to break in with a Roman Reigns breaking update.
Mm-hmm.
And when I tuned in, it didn't. It took an hour later for them to break in, but the Punk documentary was airing, and I seen the Mercury.
All right.
Mercury.
All right. We know that Joey Mercury.
He's got big ass head, too.
Big head.
Yeah.
And speaking of big heads.
Yeah, what?
Congratulations. Although, I'm not on the best terms with the guy, and I've admitted that numerous times, but Big Vito, congratulations, brother.
On what?
Got married over the weekend.
I did not know
got
that.
Got married over the weekend.
Congratulations, man.
Yeah, got married over the weekend.
Did
so
see pictures of her?
Congrats to you.
She's hot.
I don't know.
He usually does. You gotta give him his credit. He does pretty good.
Gotta give him his credit.
He's pretty good with the ladies.
Gets the ladies.
I mean, he's got a big-ass nose, but he's a pretty good-looking cat.
Big-ass nose, big-ass
head,
big-ass ego, big-ass...
He got the style. You know, he wears the leather jacket and the fucking turned around berets. Like, he's got the Guido fucking Italian mobster thing going on.
He's got the Italian mobster thing, yet the last time we saw him on WWE television, the motherfucker was wearing dresses.
Yeah, so well, I'm thinking back to the Mama Lukes and WWE.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
What was the ECW group of all the Italians?
The Mama Lukes.
No, that was the...
It was the guys that had the tractors, right? That was
Mexico. What the fuck was their tag team name in WCW then? I thought that was the Mama Lukes.
No, the Mama Lukes was Tony...
No, his name was Tony Mama Luke. You're thinking of that. There was an ECW fact. If you get the chat...
Who was his tag team partner from up here? He lives in Albany.
Johnny the Bull... Stamboli. And then them together were the Mama Lukes in WCW. But in ECW, he was part of an Italian faction... Get that chat up. They'll tell us.
We'll get the chat. Hot-blooded Italians?
No, that's not
it. Is that it?
No.
Somebody in the chat room, what was the name
full
of...
Full-blooded Italians.
Full FBI.
Nobody said it either.
With Nunzio and...
Little Guido at the time.
Little Guido, right.
I think Tony Mama Luke might have been part of it.
That's who it was.
Tracy Smothers was in it?
Okay. No, the Mexicals were...
Juventud
Guerrera. I remember that group back in the day. They would come out in the John Deere tractors. All right, so...
Really?
Yeah, they'd ride the tractors out.
That's
and they
racist as fuck.
He was holding it. That's... Alberto Del Rio just put a photo up the other day claiming that WWE was racist. And
that is clearly racist.
Yeah, yeah.
That's like all Mexicans are fucking yard workers.
They mow the lawns $4 an hour, this, that, and the other thing. All right, so backstage throughout the night, Jamie Noble and Joey Mercury are out there looking for Dean Ambrose. They're told to find him. If they don't find him, they're going to be fired.
Noble's been the one getting physically, grabbing him by the throat one night. Yeah,
right. All right, we had Dolph Ziggler retain the IC title. We had him earlier in the day.
Chicago.
He got a huge reaction.
Yeah, they loved
it. What do you think about Ziggler keeping the title? I love it, man. I love it, man.
I like it and I don't like it. I like it because at least he's winning, at least he's on TV, and he's got a belt. But those belts usually make guys seem...
Yeah.
They do more bad than good. I know. It's insane. When I was a kid, I was always a fan of the IC title.
Yeah.
More than the world title.
Yeah, yeah. It's pathetic the way they use the United States and the IC title these days.
It's a joke.
It's a joke. All right. So we had Dolph Ziggler pick up the win there. Another backstage segment.
Oh, yeah, the Wyatt family thing. We should bring that up. The Wyatt family video package.
Yeah, we're right there. That's next.
Oh, I thought you just hit the Mercury Noble thing.
Well, there was another backstage segment with Mercury and
because I see one here too. So they went back a million times.
Oh, a bunch of times, man. Eventually, they found him in the ring when he came out to cut the promo.
No magician tricks where he was locked in a room and magically.
That was kind of weird.
They didn't even address that, did they?
He left the briefcase in the ring. But then he had another
briefcase.
But
I'm saying they never addressed tonight or last night what happened the previous week on Raw where he just magically got out of the room, magically appeared under the thing next to the announcer's table.
No, they didn't say anything about
that.
Right.
Which that deserves an explanation. Michael, how did he
get
there? How did he do that?
How did he get there, right? All right, we had the Wyatt video. Looks like they're going to split the Wyatt family. Luke Harper is in line for a fairly big push from the
singles push.
A lot of people, before they came up...
And he's the one that works. Out of him and Eric Rowan, Rowan's got the cooler look because he's a redhead with a big fucking red beard, bald head. But Harper, he can work.
A lot of people said before they were called up to the main roster down in NXT, Harper was a fucking star down
Harper
there,
was the... Well, in
he
NXT?
He was the real deal.
He was, yeah. Right. Well, they were doing the Wyatt family thing in NXT.
Right, but they said that he was a great worker
when you see him in the tag matches, he's got that badass... He's very like JBL, not just because of the clothesline, but he's got that rugged fucking... rough style,
right.
Like the APA.
Like
had.
Sheamus or something like that?
Like Sheamus. Like I consider it like the APA. They just go in and beat it looks like they're beating the shit out of people because they're beating the shit out of people.
Hey, JBL shut down his Layfield website.
LayfieldReport.com. Well, he got a new one.
Tie it in. It looks
so
like he signed a deal with a major media conglomerate.
They're
going to
distribute his podcast, this and that.
Right. All right, we had, let's see, there was Mustard, remember?
Mustard on his face because he stopped to get a hot dog.
They
which we found out later.
They were looking all over the place, and they were in the catering area, they were at the merchandise stand, this, that, and the other thing, and all of a sudden Stephanie spots some mustard.
Stupid.
Jamie says, well, I was looking for him, but I stopped and got a bite to eat.
And it seems like a throwaway dumb joke or comment, but it ended up playing into it because Ambrose says, I've been chilling back here at the concession stand. I actually saw you guys. One of you had a hot dog.
I want to say that's a rib, Where somebody had some mustard or some ketchup on their face,
like
or something
coffee,
like that.
Remember the coffee thing? With yes. It's got to be something like
There's
that.
There's got to be some sort of rib.
Somebody's going to create a meeting. Like, is that mustard meeting. On your suit, sir? Yes. Or something like that. Let's put that on TV.
They're at a creative team meeting, and Vince McMahon or somebody has got mustard or something.
No, it would be somebody else.
It wouldn't be Vince.
Would be like, what the fuck? You're in a professional meeting here.
You're in a professional meeting, and you got
change
mustard.
Change your shirt. You got mustard on your shirt.
It's got to be something.
I didn't think of that. I guarantee you that's what it was.
Little stupid things like that, you guys don't realize that that shit plays out on TV.
We pointed it out.
We pointed it out all the time, but for new listeners, little things like that, they say, oh, let's make
it's
that
It's funny,
because
I swear to God, it never even crossed my mind. So you just said that, I guarantee
It didn't cross my mind last night until right now.
I guarantee you that's what it is. Now that you say that, I guarantee you. All right. That's not a Clark's thinking too fucking much into something. That's guarantee you that's what
little,
it is.
Little things like that.
Because otherwise, what the fuck was the point of that?
Right.
There's
right.
literally no reason for it.
Right. Tyson Kidd was on Raw last night. Layla defeated Rosa Mendez.
Yeah.
I thought there was a Divas match later on. No, it was the two worst Divas on the roster. It was Cameron and Eva Marie teamed up. The two worst Divas.
Yeah, to take
divas.
On one Diva in a handicap match.
Yeah, because it was two of the
was
worst
Nikki
Divas.
Bella? It was Brie, because Nikki said, when you quit, I had to do handicap match.
Exactly.
Now you're going to do it. Yeah,
and it was the two worst Divas on the roster, and Cameron and Eva. Of course, it all tied into
That's
Total
a joke
Divas.
Too, yeah.
It all tied into Total Divas, but I thought it was a joke.
That's
that
kind of a rib, too.
Two,
like, let's put
the two
worst two, and let's see what happens.
And they can't even beat one girl.
That's what they call a monitor sell it backstage, where everybody wants to gather around, because they know it's going to be a train wreck, and it's going to be funny to laugh at.
Exactly.
You know?
Exactly. Brie was the only good work
in
there. Those ones aren't bad in the ring.
I think they're great.
They're pretty good.
I don't know about great, but they're damn good. I think they're underrated.
Right. I do too.
I think they're very underrated.
Good. All right, how about this? We'll leave off with Dean Ambrose comes out and cuts that promo, starts auctioning off the merchandise. So we'll come back after the commercial break in our numero dos.
Go eat a hot dog, and then we'll talk about the rumor.
A little bit of mustard on our face, some ketchup. All right, after the what you talking about rumors?
Is that the new one?
The rumors? All right.
I keep waiting for you. What you talking about, Willis?
What you talking about? I brought that up so many times, and nobody knows what I'm talking about. When I said, what you talking about, Willis?
You'd have to be a little older.
Yeah.
That would be what, late 70s, early 80s? You talking about
80s?
Yeah.
Yeah, probably.
Gary Coleman. And,
yes.
Yeah.
All right. So here we go. We'll go to a commercial break. We'll come back. On the flip side, we are doing your rapid-fire questions. We'll leave about 30 minutes for that. We're taking your live phone calls as well. So if you guys want to call us up, we'll give out the live phone number here as soon as we come back from the commercial break. So tell them, rapid-fire, how can they submit questions for you and I tonight? And they got to keep it one line, right?
It's pretty easy.
All right.
Actually, it's not. Do you have your Facebook up now?
I can go in there and I can put the rapid fire up.
No, here, didn't you say because it was logged into mine? Okay, yeah, you can just go to your page.
Sir,
fuck.
Page.
Yeah, if you want to participate in the rapid fire segment, hour number two, you just go to facebook.com/ Ryan Clark WCR one more time. That's facebook.com/ from Guns N' Roses. Ryan Clark WZR. He's a guitar player with a big hat. Anyways, Facebook.com/ Ryan Clark WZR. Once you get there, top post, last for your rapid fire questions and comments. Keep them brief. Keep them online. Please, God, that takes
one
a long time
line.
To read.
One
yeah.
line.
And we will answer as many as we can in a rapid style fashion, much how I'm speaking now, in our numero dos when we get back from the break, which he's going to take us to right about now.
You're listening to WZR TV Tuesdays with Matt Boone, Ryan Clark. We'll be back talking Dean Ambrose right after this. Now you can do that. The rumors?
What you talking about?
What you talking about?
Especially on a radio show. Thankfully we're a TV show.
It's really juicy chicken too. But anyways, we are back for our numero dos.
Are you sure?
Here on WZR TV Tuesdays. Matt Boone, Ryan Clark, we're going to be here for the next 1 hour, the final hour of this shindig. Going to give out the live phone number here in just a couple of minutes. We are going to finish up Monday Night Raw from last night, talk some news, talk some rumors. Ran most of that stuff down in our numero uno, but pretty much all hour number two is going to consist of you guys, your questions out of the live chat room from the rapid fire, facebook.com/ Ryan Clark WZR, and your live phone calls as well. Give out the number here in just a couple minutes. So we left
should make a new game.
Yes.
We should predict what Jackie's topic's going to be about.
Rusev and Lana.
I agree.
Yeah.
She seems to find one thing.
Well, they had the big flag segment last night on Raw. That's going to be a big deal here.
So it's actually topical this week. Here, yeah. This is probably her right here. Let me get the air conditioner off. Go ahead.
Caller, you are live on WZR-TV. What's going on?
What's going on, Ryan? What's going on, Matt?
How you doing, man?
Good. Hey, guys, I got two quick football things for you that maybe you didn't know about, and then I had something about Raw last night. So before you let me go, I just want to say those three things that that's cool. Ryan, for you, the Bills did bench E.J. Manuel. Their new quarterback as of right now is Kyle Orton. He used to be with the Cowboys last year, so that's who they're going with.
When did they bench? Hold on a minute. When did they bench E.J. Manuel? Because at the end of that game, they were doing the final drive, and E.J. is the one that threw that pick on the final drive.
Yeah, it was after the game. After the game last night, and it was early this morning, or sometime last night, where they said they were changing quarterbacks.
Oh, wow.
And
so they're going
to... Kyle Orton, he used to be with the Cowboys last year. He's named the starter now.
No, I know who Kyle Orton is. I know he used to be with the Chicago Bears, I believe. No. But I know we had him as a backup. I didn't know that they benched EJ. You know what? I like that then.
No, I think
then,
he's saying that they're gonna bench him next week. Right?
No, they're saying that you're saying that Kyle Orton's gonna start next week, correct?
So they're benching EJ.
Yeah, he's going to be their starting quarterback.
I like that.
Forward, they said.
I like that, man. I like that a lot. I would rather have. I mean, EJ's a good quarterback. Don't get me wrong. He's going to be a good quarterback in the coming years, but not right now.
And then the Lions, and then your wrestling thing. Go ahead.
Oh yeah. And then Matt. They also said. I mean, it's not as probably just talk right now, but they said. Indomik Sue is probably going to be leaving the Lions in free agency. He said that he'd like to go to one of the New York teams.
You know, I brought that up in hour one. I covered that. What's the, and your wrestling thing real quick?
Oh, yeah. And, Jesus Christ, please keep Hulk Hogan off my TV. He makes Brock Lesnar look like, Paul Heyman on the mic. Jesus Christ.
Yo, we're gonna get into Hogan here in a second, man. We'll run down that promo, but I agree 100%.
Yeah, stay tuned. We got the opinion of very safe. All right. Thanks for the call, by the way, man.
Thanks, dude. He's a good guy, man. He calls in every week, man. He's
but
a good
with
dude.
The Hogan thing, right, he was doing the promotional thing.
Dean Ambrose.
Who else would do it?
Let's talk about Dean Ambrose first. So Dean Ambrose comes out, cuts this promo, right? He's basically got the Money in the Bank briefcase, and inside the Money in the Bank briefcase, he's got a bunch of merchandise.
I forgot
doing,
about
right?
This.
He's
yeah,
got t-shirts and everything else, right? Mm-hmm. All this stuff is coming out of the briefcase.
But he was at the concession stands where they ate the hot
dog. Since
when
is the briefcase? Yeah. It always contained either nothing or... I guess the briefcase contains whatever the person wants.
Punk said in his documentary that he said it was a rib on him because now I got to carry this fucking briefcase around. It's got a big WrestleMania logo plastered on it.
Right,
so everywhere I go, everybody's like, "Oh, you're a WWE wrestler."
Money in the Bank.
He's like, "So it must have been a rib on me to give it to me because he won it twice. Right, so the second time he thought he was being ribbed."
Well, I guess if
he
got
said,
a briefcase,
all right. He said, "Well, I kept my luggage in it. At least
why
I got
not?
You know, yeah. If I got to carry it around, at least I got my
if
stuff.
If you've got a briefcase, why not fucking use it? Put it to good use, you know." So, anyways, he starts auctioning off all these t-shirts. He's like, 25 cents for this one. I'll give you $2 for this one. $1 for this one. You know, basically making a mockery of Seth Rollins. I don't care about any of his stuff. I just care about the briefcase. So, right? So, eventually, Jamie Noble and Joey Mercury eventually find him because he's dead square in the center of the ring auctioning off stuff.
I think he challenged him to come out, right?
So, he basically, they come down to ringside, but they're afraid to get into the ring, right? So, Ambrose is like, all right. Ambrose had a line. He says, well, I'm glad to see you set your cruiserweight division out to fucking tackle me.
That was a great line.
It was awesome.
That's the kind of stuff, too,
the
you know.
The crowd popped huge.
That's
man.
The kind of stuff where you know he's taking chances, because there ain't a fucking chance in hell
that
was in the script.
Absolutely.
There's no way.
Nope. That was a shoot. That was a
That's CM Punk style, where it's like, all right, I got you right my promo, but everybody says it too, Jim Ross. Everybody says it. If you want to really get, you got to take chances.
You got to take chances, and if it pisses off WWE management, you're fucked. But if it doesn't,
but if it works,
But the crowd popped.
If it pisses it off, but it works, then right. they got to let you do it. Like, when Punk is a perfect example. He would piss them off every week, but it would so clearly work
that
you can only say so much.
Yeah, but I think Punk was in another league than Ambrose is, but...
How he got to that league, because he would do it anyway.
I don't know. I think when Punk came back, they wanted him back so badly. When he came back the first time, they wanted him back so badly that when Punk came back, he said, you know what, I can go out there and I can say whatever the fuck I feel like, because I don't care.
No,
if I get fired, if I quit, I don't care.
But he was already doing that, and that's why he would even say, they would hand me my promo, and he's like, it was a dickhead move, but just to prove a point, I would rip it up and throw it. And even guys like Michael Hayes on the documentary, they said, and Punk was a dick, he would literally rip up the script. Like, he was confirming what Punk, it wasn't like just Punk saying.
But he would hit the bullet points, but then add extra things into it.
He would just do it. They would not only hit the bullet points, he would say, you need to work. Come pull me aside, and we'll work on it together. You can't tell me what's in my head, because you'll be wrong 100% of the time.
Right.
Bottom line, though, is, that's what Stone Cold says it too. He's like, you got to take chances. They give you a script. Right. I know you don't want to rock the boat, but you're never going to get ahead if you don't take chances and make yourself hurt.
He
says the problem is, though, you got to have the talent to back it up. Don't go out there and take chances if you know you're not a good talker.
Ambrose took a chance. Ambrose, being a great talker,
exactly,
took a chance last night with that cruiserweight line.
Well, that's
and the crowd popped. Huge.
That's a very
popped huge.
Very minor example.
Very minor example. No,
yeah, it's just
very,
a little one-liner.
A little one-liner, but it worked.
It worked great.
And I think that WWE management, that was one of those little one-liners, like you're talking about, that WWE management said, you know what? He ad-libbed
of course.
There, and it worked.
If
it
they
worked.
Addressed it at all backstage, it would be like, huh, I see you threw on a little joke there.
Pretty good.
Yeah. Made like a little comment, but I don't think that would be one of those like, what the fuck was that cruiserweight?
I don't think
it's that big of a deal.
It wouldn't go that far. It wouldn't go that far, but it was...
But that's what it takes. It takes balls.
I liked it.
It takes going off and doing your own thing.
I liked it.
You don't go completely off script in the point that, like you said, you're not hitting your bullet points.
Right.
But if you can and spice it up and add a little
spice it up.
And you know what I mean?
So anyways... Noble and Mercury, they wind up not getting in the ring. Instead, they run backstage, and it's basically to tell, hey, we found him, he's in the ring, and that brings out Seth Rollins. And that's where Ambrose says, basically...
Well, Ambrose leaves the ring, and he's like, go ahead, go get it.
No, Rollins comes down the ramp, and Ambrose says, listen, there's no bad feelings. Hold on, I
think that's Jake.
Go ahead, take it. Ambrose says, basically, I don't want no beef tonight. Take it. Go ahead, take it. He goes out in the audience, and Dot Rollins comes down, takes the briefcase, and then goes up to the top of the ramp with Triple H and Stephanie McMahon, who are out there at that point.
Well, no, he opens the briefcase, and it's...
Or he opens it. He gets to the middle of the ring, he opens it, and it sprays up a bunch of green slop
or whatever.
So,
like you can't do that on television. Remember Nickelodeon? They would throw the gunk on top of your head, and it was green gunk.
It was the award show that they have. Every year, they still do it.
The Kids' Choice Awards. That's a Nickelodeon thing. Yeah.
Right.
It started from that, you can't do this on television.
So anyways, Rollins gets all pissed off, he goes to the top of the ramp, and he's up there with Triple H and Stephanie McMahon at that point, who come out, and he's all pissed off, you can't do this to me. Alright, we'll get right back into Monday Night Raw. Actually, we leave off, we had Bo Dallas pinned Mark Henry, that was kind of weird. Caller, hold on 1 second, we had Bo Dallas with a clean pin over Mark Henry?
Yeah.
Obviously, it was a fluke type victory. We had
it was a backstage segment too, where they announced the main events. It was Kane and Orton, if you scroll up a little bit. Kane and Orton looking for Ambrose and Cena. Yeah, and then they get told the main events and this and that. It was a bunch of shit there, and Seth talked about what had just happened. But anyways, so then we go into that.
There was the Brie Bella, this is what we talked about earlier, it was kind of the two worst divas on the roster. It was Eva Marie and Cameron, man, against Brie Bella.
Cameron went back to NXT, according to Total Divas, so she shouldn't even be on the...
This was a couple of months ago, though.
Total Divas is taped. Yeah.
Right, remember when she had... Was it Naomi that had the eye injury, or
it was
Naomi.
Cameron?
Okay. Well, Cameron went back down.
She took a knee from, who was it?
It was Naomi, you're right.
No, who
you're
gave
right.
it to her? I'm trying to think of the name.
I don't remember who gave it
a
to her.
A little chubby one that's kind of hot. Fuck.
Not Rosa.
Not chubby, but big fat ass.
Big fat ass? Layla?
Fuck, I can't think of it. No.
A little chubby
two names. She's got a first and a last name. I can't think of it. That's going to bug
on Raw every week? Get out of here. Diva?
No, she's very rarely on, but she was on that week.
I don't remember.
Oh,
I don't
know. Bring the chat up when you get a sec.
All right. Then we had, it was like the Battle of the Animals, right? Slater Gator is what they're calling him these days. Against the Los Matadores. Basically, Hornswoggle comes out dressed up as an alligator. You've got the bunny out there. You've got Adam Rose on commentary here. You've got all sorts of... You've got the bull out there with the Los Matadores. It was just a complete...
Oh, that's going to drive me
nuts. A complete clusterfuck. I'll think of it here
just
in a second.
Just bring the chat up for 2 seconds. I guarantee you they both spammed it with it.
We'll get the chat up. Hold on.
It's like a Spanish name or something. Oh, it's Oksana.
Oksana.
I can't think of that. Yeah.
All right. No doubt. So we had... I mean, that was... The whole point of that was to feud the gator, the bunny, and the bull, right? You've got all three of them out there. A bunch of fucking animals, right? Then...
A bunch of fucking animals.
Speaking of fucking animals, we had Rusev and the Big Show. Let's talk about Rusev and the Big Show.
Yeah,
I'm pretty 100. Caller, you are live on WZR-TV. We're talking about Rusev and the Big Show from Monday Night Raw last night. What you want to talk about?
Hello, guys!
Hey. Boom! Jacqueline in the house. You see what we did there, Jackie?
Yes, I did. I was listening.
Yes.
What's
on your mind this week?
What's going on with you guys?
We're talking about Rusev and Big Show. We want to know what you want to talk about.
What's on your mind?
That was exactly what I was just about to say. I want to talk about the total disrespect of the Big Show last night, which really ticked me off.
I gotta tell you.
Excuse me. If you have a problem with Russia, then you can tell them. It's just that you don't disrespect the flag. Because as I told you guys that my high school teacher is related to a former Russian professional hockey player. And he played for the NHL. And I'm like, okay, if Sergey was here right now watching this with me, he would be yelling in Russian because of the disrespect. And I'm like, okay, you know, yeah, I have no problem with Big Show, but, you know, that's totally disrespectful in my book. And Lana got really upset because I wanted to hear what else she wanted to say before she got rudely interrupted. I think she was going to say, I want to know what the rest she was going to say, what else she was going to say, because, you know, I'm like, okay.
Probably, shut up, shut up. You know how she says that?
Yeah, shut up, you know what I mean? She would have done something like that. But listen, what do you think? I mean, WWE.com, they came out, they issued an apology. I mean, clearly...
And listen, they put over Russia every week, Vladimir Putin, and this is the greatest leader in the world. Like, why don't they get credit for that?
They knew that as soon as Big Show ripped that flag down from the ceiling,
they
knew that they were going to get heat and a lot of media outlets and people like that.
Big Show did it on his own?
No, absolutely.
I don't think so either.
Absolutely not. But they knew the feedback and the response that they were going to get from that, as if you disrespect, no matter what country it is, you know, whether it be Russia or, you know, another country that we're not on good terms with, you're going to get a lot of heat from the media, and that's...
It's not as bad as HBK laying out the Canadian flag and humping it or picking his nose with the Canadian flag.
Right.
Like, he did some fucked up shit.
And that's what happened today, where they did an angle on Raw last night. They ripped down the Russian flag. They put it down to the ground. Big Show did it. And they already had an apology ready to go, and that's what popped up on WWE.com earlier today. And, you know, you knew that that was coming. You knew that today the media was going to throw a fit, and that's what happened. So WWE issued a, you know, kind of baseless apology, but what are you going to do?
Well, okay, here's another thing. What if someone came over to your place and ripped out, say if someone was a Giants fan, and I know that you're a Bills fan, what if that Giants fan came over and ripped down your Bills flag, if you had a Bills flag flapping on your flagpole? You'd be ticked off as well.
Well, that's a little bit different. Listen, Jackie, that's
like
a little bit.
You're
talking about a country. Exactly. You're talking
about
a country.
She's trying to give you an analogy that would work for you. You're
the analogy
about the Bills.
I'm just saying.
Listen, Jackie.
And someone did that to Well, I'm a hockey girl too. Ask anyone I know, because I'm a wingnut.
Boone.
And someone did that.
Boone and I, listen, Jackie, Boone and I agree 100% with you where it was a disrespectful thing to do, but you gotta, you know, it's entertainment, you know, it's WWE.
Oh, did you say something that it wasn't a big deal? Oh, no, it was a big deal,
and you knew that it was gonna be a big deal today, and I don't care which country it is. I mean, if you rip down a flag and you throw it on the ground, this, that, and the other thing, the media is gonna be pissed off, and the country's gonna be pissed off, and that's what happened last night on Raw, so we don't disagree, not at all.
Anything else,
agree.
Real quick though, we got a lot of callers and a lot of stuff to get to in very little time.
One more thing, Jackie, what do you got?
I want to ask you, are you watching the Bills game on Sunday?
Absolutely.
Who they got this? Oh, the Lions!
Do you know who
they got
playing?
The Lions. Of course, it's the Bills and the Lions. I got a
Lions versus Ryan.
I got a Lions fan sitting right next to me, and I got a Bills fan right here talking to you. So Bills, Lions.
We're all over that game.
I'm
is that gonna be on TV?
I'm gonna kick Boone's ass. What do you think?
I'm gonna be cheering for both because I don't want to get too upset because you're a Bills guy.
Yeah.
And I'm a Lions girl.
Are you?
Jackie's
serious?
A Lions girl. I didn't know that.
Jackie.
What's up, Jackie?
Jackie.
We got Lions, baby.
Man.
Yeah.
I've got no problem with the Bills.
You got a problem with the Bills this Sunday because they're playing our Detroit Lions.
I've always wanted to go to New York, and I've got no problem with the Bills.
Jackie, I'm going to, listen, we're going to talk to you next
you
Tuesday.
Check out my,
Jackie?
You should check out my Facebook ad because I make a lot of loom knitting stuff.
Jackie,
check it out.
Jackie,
we'll check
I'm
out
gonna,
your Facebook. We got to get going.
Jackie, I'm going to talk to you next Tuesday night, but man, I can't believe you're a Lion.
Hey,
man.
I love it.
We'll talk next Tuesday night.
I like the Bills, too.
I love you, Jackie.
Week,
we love you, Jackie.
Thanks for the call, Jackie.
We
we'll talk to you next week, honey.
Nope. Oh,
I'm sorry
man.
If I cut her off.
Oh,
no,
man.
Yeah.
Jackie's a Lions fan.
I did not know that.
Jackie's a Lions fan.
You learn something new every week. Me and Jackie got the same team in football.
Jackie.
If this guy calls again,
Jackie.
He's called like 20 times. All we gotta let him in. And
Jackie's
then,
a Lions fan?
We'll be quick with him. Man. We gotta get to this
run. All right. Back to Monday Night Raw, and then we gotta get the rapid fire. We got about a half an hour left, so we're still on pace here. Alright, we left off with the whole animal.
The second we get going
best.
Into something.
Alright, we had Rusev, the guy that was just calling. Call back real
he's
quick.
He's called 100.
We've only got one phone line. And as soon as we get through Monday Night Raw, we're going to give out the live phone number, and then you guys can call us up, and we'll mix it up with the rapid
Where's
fire
Callie
as well.
Been? I hope that's Callie calling, even.
Was it 6?
It's 7-something.
6? No, it's not Callie. All right, we had, so we talked about Rusev and Big Show, right? I mean, Rusev, or Big Show
we
came
out.
We just
talked to Jackie
about
it, yeah.
American flag. We had Alicia Fox
God,
against
that was
AJ
another
Lee.
Divas match,
Two
right.
Divas match on,
Wouldn't that be the third?
On Raw last night. Two of them.
Wasn't there one early, and then you said later there was a handicap? Mm.
Oh, you know what? Was that 3D?
I
we
think
had
there was.
The, Brie Bella and
I
Eva
that
Marie.
Was the
there was
second.
One up here too, right?
Maybe not.
I guess there wasn't.
Okay.
No. I thought that. Yeah, I thought you were right though. All right.
Oh,
yeah.
There was. We just passed it. It was Tyson Kidd with Natalya and
That's,
all that.
Natalya was out there.
Yeah,
and,
go up a little bit more. Yeah, it was. It was Layla.
Layla was out there.
Versus Rosa with Natalya in one corner, Summer Rae in the other.
Three Divas match.
One show. And some backstage things with Nikki Bella.
Yeah.
Talking about now Bree's got to do a handicap match.
Yeah.
There was a lot of Divas. I guess Total Divas is full in effect.
All right.
In full effect.
And they kept plugging Total Divas last night.
That's
man,
what,
too.
Yeah.
It's over and over.
Have you watched any episode this season of Total Divas?
Zero.
I've seen them all.
I've seen the
I don't
highlight
watch them
clips.
On TV. I watch them the next day.
You know how they put the highlight clips up on YouTube?
Yeah.
I watch all of those. So
that
I
gives
know
you the, that gives you
the
main
general
stuff.
Gist.
Right, most of it is just it's setting those segments up, and then they go to commercial.
And then they expand on them?
No, they set the segments up, then they go to commercial.
Right.
Then they come back, they set them up again, and then they go to them.
Right.
And then
right.
they set up the next segment, go to commercial, come back, set it up again, then go to it. So it's pretty much when you watch the clips on YouTube...
Yeah.
You pretty much see the essence of the
you
entire show.
You hate reality television.
I hate it, but I like anything
any,
behind
you like
the
backstage
WWE.
Stuff.
Yeah,
you
any
like
kind of
stuff.
Non-regular scripted show,
right.
even though it's kind of a scripted
right.
show.
It's
it just feels...
kind of a scripted
you get
show.
To see
it's
them,
the most scripted show.
I'm just
television.
Saying, you get to see them setting up the ring. You get to see the seamstress making the outfits. You get to see Mark Carano talking to them. You know, even though a lot of it's set up, it just it gives you a glimpse into that world, and I like that look.
Guys, a reality TV fan right here.
I hate it.
A reality TV fan.
Oh, you're on there. What's going on? What's on your mind?
Hey, what's going on, boys?
How
you doing, man?
First off, I wanted to get your thoughts on this Luke Harper promo.
No, it's the vignette, the Luke Harper.
Well, he said first off, he might have had a couple other.
I didn't hear first off. I apologize. Right. Call back in.
Well, anyways,
the Luke Harper. We talked about it. They're giving him a singles push, and it looks like he might go heel.
It wasn't a Harper promo. It was like a vignette for the Wyatt family.
But it kind of focused on Harper a lot, and there was even a shot that I took a still of for the article image, and it was Bray and Harper kind of face to face making.
So you think they're going to do Harper and Bray?
They might. I don't think that's what the video is teasing.
Yeah.
But I think that if Harper goes heel, then Bray would probably be face, and that would be the initial thing.
Would the storyline be that Harper and Rowan get fed up with Bray's antics? Would that kind of be the reason behind the split?
I haven't heard of Bray's crazy. Yeah, Bray's, I don't know. I haven't heard of any involvement about Rowan. I don't know how he plays into it, but I really get the feeling that it's going to be a Harper Wyatt. It'll be some off the fucking wall. Back when Sister Abigail was teaching
something
her,
weird.
It'll be
right,
something we have
right,
no fucking clue
right.
talking about. But that'll set up Harper and Bray,
right?
And then after that, they go their separate ways, kind of like the Shield, you know.
And one other thing, another big story that kind of broke today is Randy Orton. While we're on the subject of backstage news. They've already kind of planted the seeds with a Randy Orton babyface turn.
There's a lot of little subtle things.
Where, week after week, it seems like Randy Orton and Kane as well are starting to get fed up with, they're having to go out there. Having to go out there and do the dirty work for Seth Rollins. Yes,
quit causing problems and then assuming we're going to fix them for you.
The fires that we have to put
and that's
out.
That's the way they worded it. Yeah, the fires thing. Right, and then there was even little subtle things like the pre-show for Night of Champions. It was the peep show with Christian and Jericho, and then Orton pops up in the Titantron, and he's doing fucking stand-up comedy routine, telling jokes, and that's a baby-faced look.
Yeah,
so there's little things here and there, and those are the obvious signs, like, we're getting sick of having to do your dirty work for you, kind of thing.
I think if that continues, where it's all about Rollins, the authority is all about Rollins, like Triple H and Stephanie McMahon, all about Rollins, Randy Orton and Kane.
Timeline wise, what did you hear? I heard 3 months.
3 to 4 months. That would take us into WrestleMania.
It would be right around Rumble time.
Before that, yeah.
So maybe he could screw somebody he spoke. All right, you know how they keep telling him, you need to do this for us? Maybe they tell him, you need to make sure Reigns doesn't win.
And then he goes out there and screws him.
And then he helps Reigns or something, and that's the beginning, and then we're going to WrestleMania.
Well, not only with that, but if he were to help Reigns, and Reigns would
be back. That's just an example. Don't get stuck on that.
Okay. But let's say that were to happen, that would set up a singles match, number one, between Orton and Rollins, and then, in addition to that, you could do a tag team match, Orton and Reigns against Rollins and Rollins and
I don't know if that's
H,
what they're doing, I just use that as an example, they'll probably give him, if it's going to happen around Royal Rumble time, the way to do it would be, here's your mission, you're not out there to win the Rumble, you're out there to make sure this guy doesn't win.
And Orton says, fuck that.
And then, somebody's getting ready to eliminate, let's say it's Reigns. Somebody's getting ready to eliminate Reigns, and Orton goes over and stops that guy and throws him out.
Right.
And then afterwards, the promo, motherfucker, they were about to throw Reigns out, and your only job, I'm tired of doing what you want me to do.
You've got a 3 to 4 month build to build Randy Orton as a major babyface going into WrestleMania.
And I've heard,
that would make sense.
There's one particular reporter, which is kind of the godfather of our world, says that that he's not going to get that over as a babyface. I completely disagree.
Depends on how he's booked, man.
I think him as a face, period, over like Rover. I think the fans, it'll be something bad example of Cena did it because Orton's flip flop back and forth heel to face. But when he's a face, he gets over.
If Orton feuds as
he's
a babyface,
a better heel.
Orton's definitely a better heel.
Yeah,
but if Orton feuds with the Authority. Okay, going into wrestling, then he's going to be a huge babyface. But if they turn him babyface and then they go a different direction where he's not feuding with the Authority, they've got to continue.
Weak heel, he's got to have a strong heel to go against so that the people really get behind him.
They've got to continue. I think if they turn Randy Orton babyface, against the Authority, which looks to be what
they're leading to. Well,
that would
be the first one. Yeah, that has to be the first one.
I mean, they've got to go for a while with that. And I think if they
and
went,
they can because they've got Kane, if, Triple yeah, H, but Rollins.
If they went for a while with Randy Orton feuding with the Authority as a babyface, yeah. I think he could skyrocket and become a major babyface. Well, it's just if you do an Orton Authority feud for 3 or 4 weeks and then that's it.
That's my point, though. No, they wouldn't because he's got different levels. He can start Orton Rollins. That goes through a month until the pay-per-view. Then you go Orton right. Kane. There's a second right. month. Orton finally in Triple H, and they've got that long history.
But and you've got, and you've Triple got H is Kane, the guy that's been calling you've shots. Got Kane that's kind of frustrated as well. True. But Kane's always going to be... I mean, Kane's the type of guy that... Okay, Orton's going to be the one that's really pissed.
Well, look
and
at
Kane is kind of on the back burner, like, whatever.
Look
Kane.
At the Shield. Seth Rollins was always the one trying to keep peace between Ambrose and Reigns.
Yeah,
and it right. always seemed like, all right, Ambrose is going to eventually turn... And Rollins kept trying to keep the peace, and then who's the one who ended up turning heel?
I know.
Rollins.
I know. Right.
So maybe
right.
Kane's fed up too, but maybe, you know, it could be one of those kind of things.
Could be. We'll have to wait and see. We had Sheamus defeated Damian Mizdow. Miz was on commentary during this match talking about he's a Hollywood star, oh, this, Christ. That, and the other thing.
Who had the comment? Was it Ziggler that B-level direct-to-DVD movie? I'm going to end your direct-to-DVD movie
No,
career.
It was Triple H. It was backstage. It was Triple H backstage in a, no, in a segment. No, Miz and Sandow came up backstage. It was Triple H and Stephanie McMahon, and Triple H brought up the line about a B, your straight-to-DVD movie release.
Well, there was somebody else that said it, too, because it was somebody he ended up working with in a match. I think it was Ziggler.
Hold on a minute.
Or maybe
it was Triple H last night on Monday Night Raw.
It was somebody else. I guarantee you, it was somebody else.
Let me see. Hunter Dole. Everyone checked their phones. We forgot to talk about that. Where there was a razor, something, a buzzer that was in the briefcase. There was a weird noise
like a vibrating dildo
was,
or something.
Right, that was going off in the briefcase. I don't know. This
They'll
is it right here, right? All right, the Authority is backstage, right? In came the Miz and Mizdow. Mizdow talks about, you know, his mouth is aching, and Hunter made Mizdow versus Sheamus for later on the night and threatened the Miz with termination if he ever bombarded into the Authority space again in that manner.
But that was there was something different, man. It was somebody in the ring saying it, so I don't know.
I don't remember, but you guys in the chat room last night, Triple H did make a reference to...
Yeah, no, I'm not saying he didn't, but I know it was somebody he worked with.
Triple H's line was
and I picture
pretty
it was
good
like,
last night
I
on Raw.
It was like Ambrose, but it couldn't have been Ambrose. Who the fuck was it?
It might have been a couple of weeks
Maybe
ago.
Maybe it was like last week with Ziggler?
I think I remember something. It may have been Ziggler.
I don't
right?
know.
I think
okay.
I remember something
not
from a couple of weeks ago that somebody did mention straight to DVD movies.
Yeah, B-level Hollywood, whatever the fuck.
But it was also
Triple H. Maybe it was somebody on commentary while he was wrestling. I don't fucking know.
Who knows?
It's going to bug me, though.
Triple H did it last night. I
he
can confirm that.
He said something, yeah.
But there was another time within the last couple weeks. Let us know in the chat room if you guys figured it out. We know that it was Triple H last night, but who was it before that also
I don't know it was
to,
Triple H last night.
I know that it was Triple H last night. But who else referred to The Miz as a... D-list,
it was
straight
the,
to DVD.
B Hollywood star, B-level Hollywood star, or a straight to DVD, all in your straight to DVD career,
right.
Some shit like that.
Something like that. Let us know in the chat room tonight. Speaking of our live
surprise,
chat room,
no one's saying.
I know,
no one's
saying.
Flooding the answer,
right?
Now. Maybe
Speaking
there's a delay. Go ahead.
Of our live chat room, you can get there. Lots and lots of people in there as always tonight. There's something wrong with
yeah,
the chat.
Yeah, frozen. Or something.
Speaking of our live chat room, WZRonline.com. /chat /chat. I think our chat room might have froze
There's
up.
Not
here.
Many people in it either, and there was earlier, so something's up.
Is our chat room messed up here?
Looks like it.
WZRonline.com. /chat. Not that many people signed out, man. Not that many people
that
signed out.
That scroll bar was smaller earlier.
Yeah, and that's a good thing. Because there's more people in there. All right, they're here.
All right, so you guys don't know the answer then.
So it was Triple H last night on Raw, in a backstage segment, Triple H said that Miz had all these straight-to-DVD movies, right? Who was it before that that also said the same thing that Triple H said on Monday Night Raw last night?
Dark Angels confused. Triple H did say that about Batista, but that was a long time ago.
That was Batista talking about movies, right?
Right, it was Triple H making fun of Batista. You know, you got plenty of time to do your B Hollywood, whatever the fuck. That
Robbie, A.K. Crazy Roller, hi to me, please. Hello. Say hi to Robbie tonight.
What's up, Robbie?
Want to get some chat shout-outs? We haven't done that in a long time.
There's not
time.
Many in there. We could do it, yeah.
Let's do it. All right. We've got Winter's Lair in the chat. Robbie, a.k.a. Crazy Roller for the second time. Parnelli, Dark Angel, WrestlePin 123. A-Train 001. Rock and Roll. Tasmaniac in the chat room tonight.
Said
Chris
Ziggler.
Brown in the chat room. Ziggler? Might have been Ziggler. Who else? Anthony Remy's in there. 585's in there. Harvey Fish, Jerichoholic, MN Wild 69, New York Yankee 1970 something.
Parnelli,
RUNGIT!
Robbie, aka Crazy, I don't know what the rest of it is.
Acer in the chat room tonight.
Scroll down, man. We're stuck.
Bad. Here we are. Keep it rocking.
Alrighty, then we got Rock and Roll, Ryan Clark 2, Shockmaster, Shoptaw Man, Tasmaniac, VaderMan 86, Wags 51, My Buddy Winter's Lair, and WrestlePin 12.
We got them all tonight, baby. Get to our live chat room, WZRonline.com/chat. WZRonline.com/chat. So Sheamus defeated Damian Mizdow and Seth Rollins curb stomps. John Cena and Dean Ambrose.
That was the main event. What was the main event? There was two matches.
Ambrose and Cena defeated Randy Orton and Kane. They had the tag team match earlier in the night.
Okay, yeah. Last week they had the two individuals, Orton, Cena, Ambrose, and Kane.
Correct. And then they did a tag team match this week. They did a
What was
DQ,
the big thing at the end? I forget.
DQ finish. Seth Rollins ran in, caused the DQ.
Yeah.
Ambrose and Cena cornered Rollins, and they beat up on Seth for a while. And then
he hit the curb stomp on him. Yeah, and I guess the Authority just kind of stood tall as the show ended, right?
That's the show went off the air with the Authority standing tall. Rollins and
This is why my brain's fuzzy. This is 3 hours and
drank a lot of beers tonight.
No, I'm talking about Monday. My memory is fuzzy of it. I drank a lot of beers Monday night, but when you're 3 hours deep in the play-by-play and then they go to the 10-minute overrun, I'm 3 hours and 10 minutes in. I'm just praying for this show to fucking hurry up and get over with.
This show
and if it's nothing amazing, if it's nothing amazing, I'm like, all right, come on, finish. Yeah. I'm still typing. And like you're about to say, and I'll even say it, and you tell me if I'm wrong. It seemed to drag on.
I remember a million times looking at that clock
and being like, I remember specifically it was like 9:04 p.m. And I'm like, holy fucking Christ, we're only an hour. We still got two thirds of the show to go. You have got to be kidding me. Everything was a promo, so there's a lot of typing and you know, a backstage
last
segment.
Night lagged on and on and it on did. And on. Not only that, but then they announced, like, there were like two big segments for next week's Raw. And then they announced the main
not
event.
Major, it's just Roman Reigns. Oh. Not major.
A little inside joke. But then they had the main event. They had the SmackDown main event. They had all this stuff.
A Raw match, a Raw return, over and over. They plugged the network, the Monday Night War with Austin. They plugged Austin's podcast with DDP.
Yeah, they did.
There's a lot of talk about Austin returning.
Yeah, there is. We'll talk about that here in just a second. One last thing before we get to this next caller. Thoughts on last night's Raw? I guess a school letter grade is what I'm asking for.
I gotta go D.
Yeah.
I like some of the Ambrose shit.
It wasn't good.
I didn't love it because, like, the spray in the face is such a goofy thing. You know, it's not as goofy as the magician fucking David Copperfield shit he did last week.
The fucking animals.
I like the bunny. For one reason. I'll have to say the name. SEScoops.com, this site we do. I have to do a specific image for each post. So I'm always in Photoshop. And I didn't do this one. My boss did, Shalik. But there's a picture of the bunny, like, almost like in a ground and pound position in UFC, like, fucking with his arm cocked back, and his head tilted to the side, like, getting ready to go down with the punch. It's just the greatest picture. And to me, it's like, I just love looking at that picture.
Because you get to take photos.
No, I didn't even do it.
Use your little Photoshop.
I just love the bunny.
No,
I like the way that picture looks. Like, he's a bad motherfucking bunny. You don't fuck with this bunny rabbit, you know?
You don't fuck with this bunny rabbit.
I'm haunting rabbits.
Oh, Lord.
Who's that character? Do you know the name?
Who cares?
Elmer Fudd.
Elmer Fudd.
Yeah. He's kind of got a head shape like Joey Mercury if you take his hunting hat off. Anyways, Colin, you're on the air. What's going on? What's on your mind, buddy?
Hey, what's going on, fellas? Quick question. I was wondering, is there any talk about JBL getting back into the ring for one more match? Because he talks a lot of shit during the broadcast, and I was just wondering if that will ever happen.
That's a good question. It's a unique question. Thanks for the call, by the way. You don't hear much about JBL returning, because, you know, so many guys from the past eventually return or have a, you know, right, final run or a brief thing. He did the Rumble tease. As soon as he got in, he got thrown back out. It was one of Reigns' record-breaking 12 or 13 eliminations, whatever. But, and I really popped big for that.
I
love JBL. I love that character.
JBL,
for some years, he was John...
Bradshaw Layfield.
No. Before, way back in the day, he was Justin Hawk Bradshaw. He was just Bradshaw as part of the APA. And even before the APA, he was Bradshaw. And then he was that kind of Bradshaw. Like, there was so many different carnations of him that kept him around forever.
Right.
But when he hit that JBL character, and with the smile, and I'm a wrestling god.
I got it.
I love that character.
Here's the deal. JBL on commentary, clearly he's being told from Vince McMahon and the guys.
He's Vince's voice.
Right, exactly. He's being told, he's being fed lines from the guys in the gorilla position in Vince McMahon, Triple H, the guys
he's
that are back
the heel
there,
one of the three, they and are, he's Vince's voice.
They are feeding him a lot of the lines. So a lot of the stuff you hear from JBL isn't honestly what JBL is thinking. It's lines that are being fed to him.
He delivers it well.
Improvising on his own as well. But his delivery is great. I think JBL
is so
still
fucking
in really,
entertaining.
I think JBL is still in ring shape, if you will. If they wanted him to come back and do a short run, whatever.
Didn't he
have
his neck, and that's why he had to retire?
I don't know. I don't remember.
Something.
I think that if JBL is healthy,
he would
come back.
Match.
He would come back and do another run. But
run?
Remember, a short run.
Yeah.
A short run.
Like a final,
but,
you know.
Yeah,
program.
Yeah, just a couple of months.
But who would he work
there, you know
with?
What I mean?
It would have to make sense.
Yeah, everything would have to come together. But I think he's in shape. Does it happen?
That was the question, long and short. Does it happen?
Stephanie McMahon appeared on WGN yesterday morning, right? Asked about CM Punk.
What does that have to do with anything?
Never say never.
Oh, well, yeah, you can never say never about anything. But do I see it happening? No. Do I hope it happens? Fuck yeah, I love JBL.
JBL
was, I love that character.
JBL was awesome.
I loved it. When he was, before his announcing character, I loved the JBL character. And his announcing character, I love that. Mm. I think he's great.
He's an awesome announcer.
I didn't like Lawler Cole so much.
He gets a little bit overboard.
Oh my god, there's plenty of times where he will.
Sometimes he gets overboard, but he's still, for the most part, he's pretty fucking entertaining.
But I'll say, when it was just Lawler and Cole.
Right.
And it's kind of unfair because anything that followed Jim Ross and the King was going to be a step down. Mm-hmm. I did not like the Lawler-Cole team.
Cole has come a long way. Can I say that?
No, okay. I agree.
Okay.
But that Lawler-Cole was missing. When they threw JB on there, I think that's the perfect mix.
I like it.
I didn't like Lawler-Cole, just those two. I think JBL and Cole. I think JBL and Cole have more of a rapport than Lawler and Cole do.
Right,
I think JBL and Cole have more of a meshing of styles.
Also, keep in mind that JBL and Michael Cole, for those unaware, and we have
photos
of them up, they travel together on the road. They're really good friends. Off air, when they're not on
SmackDown,
they
do
the podcast. They go hunting together.
They mountain
climbing.
JBL and Cole show.
Mountain climbing together. Everything else, and they travel from arena to arena in the same cars. So when you're a traveling buddy, it's like you and I.
Yes.
We can come on here and we can shoot the shit with each other and we can make fun at each other, this, that, because we know, I know how much you can take and you know how much I can take.
And we both know at the end of the day, even if we piss each other off, it'll be a day.
At the end of the
day,
it's
kind of a little tension.
Fuck
and
you,
then,
but we do a fucking.
And then we count it out and shake
hands.
And like, you're an asshole.
We had it on Saturday.
No, you're an asshole. And it'll be like, whatever.
We had it on Saturday night here. It's the same thing.
But that was.
But it's the same thing with JBL and Michael Cole, where they travel together. They're always around each other.
I wasn't so much pissed off at you.
Drop it. They're always around each other, and they get to know each other to the point where they... And that translates on the television on Raw and SmackDown.
Damn, you got a lot of followers. Anyways, caller, what's up? What's going on?
Well, I got 5,000 friends, too.
What's on your mind? I know.
Hey, guys. I called
earlier.
Oh, God, you're back again?
No, I'm playing.
Yeah. Speaking of JBL, he had a great line last night about Tyson Kidd. He was like, geez, Tyson Kidd never gets on Raw, and now when he is, he's not even paying attention. He's got the headphones on and stuff. But hey, what do you guys thought? You never talked about it yet. Hulk Hogan, remember I mentioned it?
Oh my God, we skipped it.
We skipped that.
Well, I mean, it's worth skipping because literally all he did was come out and point out that they're going pink for Susan G. Komen breast cancer awareness.
The deal. Hulk Hogan.
That's his role.
He plugs the network.
He plugs this charitable thing.
He can do that, but Hulk Hogan comes out, and I guarantee you, and I'm sitting there last night, and I'm in the Raw chat room, and I even said into the microphone last night, I said, when do you guys think Hulk Hogan will flub his first line? When is he going to fuck up first? When is he going to make a mistake here? And sure enough, I think there were two of them last night. And maybe I'm wrong here, but he said...
There was a bad one.
Okay,
yeah.
I think I know what he's going to say. So there were a bunch of women in the audience, okay? And they shot to him on camera.
Okay.
And right before they did, Hulk Hogan said... There are a bunch of men and women that suffer from breast cancer. I don't think men can suffer from breast cancer. So then they shot to the crowd with a bunch of women, and there were no men because men can't suffer from breast cancer.
I don't know if they can
unless,
or can't.
I don't think they can. So is that what you're talking about, caller? Is that the big mistake?
That was that one, and then there was a second one where he said, I've had some great... times here in Chicago, and he's like, and if you wanted to see those or whatever, he's like, he was saying something, and he says, but you can subscribe
to the WWE Universe. Yeah!
Oh my God.
So for $9.99, you can go subscribe to the WWE Universe.
Did he correct himself or just
No, he left it as is. Wow. No, dude, you subscribe to the WWE Network. The WWE Universe.
The members of the WWE.
The members of the WWE Universe can subscribe
to the WWE Network.
I caught you. I got you last night, man. I said that.
You got both of them.
Yeah. Those were the two.
Those were the two.
He's right.
Anything else?
Thanks for the call, bro.
Thanks, guys.
All right, man. There's always one time during the promo. Remember the WrestleMania? WrestleMania 30 where he's like, we're at the Silverdome.
Yeah.
Right?
Instead of the Superdome. That's why I asked if he corrected it, because he eventually corrected that one.
No.
Because the fans started chanting, and I think he probably overheard somebody in the audience. Oh, Superdome. Uh-huh. Superdome, brother.
Oh, my bad.
I was having flashbacks at WrestleMania 3, slamming Andre, which was in the Silverdome.
Maybe I'm wrong. I don't think that men can suffer from breast cancer.
I don't think so either.
Correct me if
I'm
wrong.
But I know that the big thing was he's about to introduce a bunch of women, and he says, we got a bunch of great men and women
here. Why would they be going pink in the month of... November, if pink is
obviously, if men can suffer from it, it's more of a women thing, because men don't have breasts.
Well.
Some have to get,
You got titties there?
But The Rock had to get breast reduction. Remember he had to get what they called bitch tit surgery?
Yeah.
To get the bitch tits taken away? You know.
I mean, there's big people that...
Well, there you go. This guy says Peter Criss from KISS survived breast cancer.
All right, so maybe there are.
Yeah, so they can.
But when they shot... To the live crowd, there were a bunch of women.
That's
going,
the point. He's about to introduce a bunch of women, and he says, we got a bunch of men over here, and then they slim the camera, and it's all women.
And they're going pink for the month of November. Yeah. Pink is a women's type color, you know?
It's the ribbon people wear is pink.
Yeah. All right, so we're wrong. But anyways. I didn't know. I don't know that men can...
I didn't know either. That's why I stayed quiet.
Cancer. Okay, my bad. All right, so we got to get to these rapid fire. And right before we went to the break, we said to these
one line.
One line.
I'm looking right. I didn't even know what you were going to, and I can see by the first.
So first up is Paul Velasquez.
But I like Paul.
Paul's a great guy.
Yeah, and he's asking about something everything. I want to talk about too.
Yeah, well, then read it.
All right, Boone. How about Conor McGregor predicting his victory beforehand and delivering just that—a first round knockout at UFC 178? Catanzaro Rousey, who's your pick? Lastly, Boone, for tit's sake, start up an MMA show on Wednesday night.
For tit's sake. Breast cancer?
I guess. It started up on men or women breast cancer.
Oh, men or women.
Did you hear the rumor?
Can men have breast cancer?
The rumors are that men can have.
What you talking about, the rumors?
And he says, start up an MMA show on Wednesday night. If you're down, lots of MMA fans on here would love the idea. P.S. Kung Lee tested positive for HGH following the loss to Bisping. He's been suspended. He's been suspended for 9 months. I did not hear that either. That's the first I've heard of that. So, wow. And he got his ass fucking whooped, so that didn't help him any. Who do you pick,
so
Rousey?
So answer the man's question. Rousey, what do we got?
Rousey, Katzengano, who do you got?
Rousey.
Rousey. And what about Conor McGregor? Predicting,
looked awesome.
Predicting a first-round knockout and getting a first-round knockout, that's a Muhammad Ali trick. He would used to call his shots, and he would make rhymes around it. You know, if he talks some more, I'll drop him in four, you know, this kind of stuff.
All right, we're going to run a little bit overboard tonight. We'll go about 5-10 minutes, try to get through as many of these as we can tonight. Tom Nelson, hey, guys. Why can't WWE sign Kurt Angle? What's the holdup? Listen, they're worried about Angle. They're worried about his health. When Kurt Angle left WWE, it was for
Here's
drugs
the famous
and
thing
alcohol
I've always heard.
And everything else.
Vince McMahon will not have an Olympic gold medalist die on his watch.
He does not.
And he's that scared.
He is very worried about
of
Kurt Angle's health.
Personal demons. We'll leave it at that. But
that's the holdup.
Arturo Velasquez Jr. Sorry, Ryan Clark, but I have to say this. Oh, I have to say this. Go Texans! Hashtag J.J. Watts is a beast.
J.J. Watts is definitely a beast, and give it up for the Texans.
Or J.J. Watt is a beast.
J.J. Watt.
Yeah.
I'm not a sore loser, man. J.J. Watt and the Texans looked really good this weekend. Give it up for Texans fans, man. If you're a Texans fan, give it up. I'm not a sore loser. David Hadley, what do you make of what do you make of that Wyatt family vignette that aired last night? Is Harper going on his own? Yeah, it looks like they're gonna do Harper in a single bush. Again from David Hadley, why are you so worried about football when the best season in sports begins tonight? The MLB postseason.
I don't like watching baseball.
Looking forward. The only time I watch baseball is the MLB postseason.
Give it up, Sox and playoffs.
Give it up for Derek Jeter. His last home game hit the walk-off double.
That was awesome. That was a moment.
That was great. And the last one from David Hadley.
Real quick, while he's talking about the postseason, who was it? Hunter Pence? Hunter?
Yes.
Started Hunter that Pence. Big yes chant.
Daniel Bryan stuff.
The last
right.
Postseason game for them.
And last one from David Hadley. Do you think there's anything to the recent rumors of Austin possibly wrestling at WrestleMania 31 or 32?
That's the talk, man. They're saying he's off getting in shape, which he always said if he was going to do a match, he'd have to get in serious, good shape.
Plug in the podcast?
And he said he'd need a good 4 to 6 months to do it. If you look, we're about 6 months away from WrestleMania.
Plugging the podcast and
7 months away, whatever it is. They're plugging the podcast.
There's some hints.
Which nobody's brought this up before, but they did plug it once or twice in the past a couple months ago.
Right. I'm glad that Cole got it right this week, saying podcast one. Last week he said podcast.com.
Oh, did he? I remember that.
This week he said podcast.
Yeah, last week he had Nash, this week DDP, but he fucked up the domain.
Matt Johnson.
Says, which WWE talent do you think would succeed in MMA? The only one we've had so far was Lesnar, who, with only a few fights, won the UFC Heavyweight Championship. Batista only had one fight. Lashley had a handful of fights, but he's very green and gas is fast.
If he was younger, William Regal. Back in the day, think Regal would have been.
I think Jack Swagger is the first thing that pops out in my brain.
Yeah.
He was an amazing amateur wrestler. I don't think he ever had a point scored against him, and he fought. He was an amateur wrestler for a big team, kind of like it was Oklahoma State. I forget.
One of the two, right?
Either
right.
OU or you know, or, yeah. But supposedly he was a beast, and he's a heavyweight, he's a good athlete.
No doubt.
Off the top of my head, I'd have to look at the roster. I'm not
Christopher
sure.
Brown, with the breakup of the Wyatts upcoming, assuming Bray turns face. I don't know that Bray's going to turn face, but we'll have to wait and see. What top heels can you see him first working with? Oh, and by the way, Ryan, EJ Manuel has been benched for Kyle Orton next week, just so you know.
Quick to point out how
I like that. I like Kyle Orton, a guy that's had experience with the Chicago Bears in the past. I like Kyle Orton coming in.
Was it the Bears?
Starting for Buffalo. I believe Kyle Orton was back.
But either way, as far as
Jay Cutler for the Bears.
As far as who would work with Wyatt as a face, what heels would? I mean, the top guys probably. The top heels.
It'd have to be,
I don't see him working low, mid-card, or anything like that. Especially if he goes single.
Yeah.
They'd have to make sure he's a big deal. I think that's why they've been kept off TVs, because they don't have anything big for them. Coming out of the Jericho thing, let's not have him do something mediocre while all our top guys are tied up or on the shelf with injuries.
Bray Wyatt's already been made a star. Maybe they're trying to take.
But he's cooling off,
man. Maybe Luke Harper's the next guy to rise up.
I don't think he rises up past Bray. I mean, unless he can talk. I haven't heard. He's kind of got a little chops when it comes to promos, but nowhere near Bray's level.
We'll have to wait and see. You never know.
You never know. But I just don't see it.
All right, what do we got next from Jay Mullen?
He says, why did TNA wait 2 weeks before Bound for Glory to announce all of their matches? The build to their quote-unquote biggest pay-per-view has been awful, in all capital letters. They're even leaving their top stars like The Wolves, Bobby Lashley, Bobby Roode, Austin Aries, Bram, the Hardy Boys, and many more off the card.
My honest feeling is they don't give a fuck about Bound for Glory this year. This is just one of those years where they are more concerned about their TV deal more than anything else. Fuck the pay-per-views.
I think they know they don't make any money on pay-per-view. They don't sell any pay-per-views.
They're not going to make anything. We're worried about
that
TV deal.
And like you said, we've got bigger fish to fry, so we can't be spending all this time worrying about a pay-per-view that might not even matter if we don't have a company after the show's over, you know.
Got to worry about the company's future with a TV deal before pay-per-view.
And the contracts of the guys, because a lot of those contracts are up at the beginning of next year.
Right.
At least the few guys they got left that have names.
Anthony Remy, is there a power struggle in WWE? Yes, there is.
That's what I've heard.
You know, it's Triple H, Vince McMahon, Stephanie McMahon. I mean,
there's even one lately, supposedly, between Triple H and Stephanie and George Barrios and Michelle Wilson.
Yeah,
one of which heads up the network. The other one, headed up the launch of the network. One headed up the TV negotiations. Both of which have been considered failures,
right?
Because the TV rights fees didn't go up nearly like they thought.
Subscribers,
the network tanked.
Didn't go
anywhere near like what they thought. And I think there's kind of from what I hear, there's been a conflict between the Triple H Stephanie side, the Barrios Wilson side.
Vince McMahon makes all the final decisions.
He's still the guy. Yeah.
He's still the guy in charge.
But he's grooming Triple H to. You know,
he's grooming Triple H, but
shadow me.
As of right now, as we're talking to you, Vince is still the final guy in charge. And a lot of times people think that Vince isn't with the times.
Speaking of Vince, Vincent Nugent's up next, Mr. Acer. He says, to follow up on Jay's question.
Nice one-line question, Vincent Nugent.
Yeah, well, he's the king of fucking...
He is the king.
Keep going on. But what do you guys think about the current announced TNA Bound for Glory 2014 card lineup and event overall? Do you think that Bound for Glory 2014 feels like an one-night-only special pay-per-view event as opposed to being the biggest pay-per-view event of the year? What are your thoughts? He says, to follow up on Jay's question. That's pretty much the same question.
Bound for Glory does seem
like a big show, only
pay-per-view. Yeah. You know, it really does. David Hadley, why can acts like Adam Rose, The Bunny, Slater Gator, Los Matadores, Hornswoggle, and The Divas get TV time on Raw, but not Kofi Kingston, Big E, Xavier Woods, Curtis Axel, Justin Gabriel, and Zack Ryder can't.
Speed Force, we should bring up that.
Yeah, I think with the new stable, Speed Force, I think they're testing it out on WWE house shows, live events, seeing how the crowd reacts to it, and then they will wind up
and they've had them work baby faces. Like
and heels.
To build off what you said, to see how the crowd reacts, let's see how they react to them as faces.
Right.
Let's see how they react to them as heels. Let's see how they react to them against this popular team or this unpopular team. Let's see what the crowd wants from these guys.
Test it out at live events before bringing it to television.
Exactly.
Correct.
Fine-tune it. David Hadley, how many Vince McMahon... we're way up here.
Yeah.
I saw that. Okay.
Just keeping it going right from the top.
My question is, who would you rather date? Who would you rather, Lana?
Ooh.
Oh, who would you rather, Lana or Layla?
Man, Layla's got that big booty. Lana's
a question
just
in my
hot.
Mind, Lana.
Yeah.
Fucking Christ.
Yeah, Lana.
Not even close.
Yeah, Lana. All right.
And I'm
Lana.
Not. I like dark brunette-haired girls more, way more than blondes.
Yeah.
But Lana is fucking smoking.
Layla got that booty, bro.
I'm not a fan of big asses.
All right. Vincent Nugent, do you guys think WWE is putting more emphasis on their Divas division in the main roster lately, with the Divas having a total of 3 matches on Raw last night in Chicago, of all places, or does that have to do with the Total Divas situation?
I think they're trying to promote
Total Divas, man.
More footage for Total Divas to air on Season 4.
We got David Hadley up next.
How many Vince McMahons does it take to screw in a light bulb?
How many Vince McMahons does it take? All
right. Yeah, it's an old joke. How many bubble does it take to screw in a light bulb?
Yeah. I don't get the joke. How many
it's an old one-liner joke. It's not the... Take out Vince McMahon. How many Mexicans does it take to screw in a light bulb? How many this does it take to... That's like a joke.
Oh.
It's not funny. I'm just saying. He might even be saying how many, like... Executives, does it take to make a fucking good WWE product because it sucks lately? And that's me guessing.
220 four.
It takes more than what they've got now, and they've got a lot now. So,
Ali Adair, who do you think the most overseas wrestler, non-Americans, who do you think is the most overseas wrestler, non-Americans? I think probably Davey Boy,
the
but then
over.
Again, I think Barrett will get there. So the most over in the
most
history?
Over overseas wrestler.
Oh, man.
He's talking about right now because he's throwing out current names.
Well, no, he's talking about Davey Boy Smith, too.
Oh, he's talking about British Bulldog. Probably Davey Boy, but then I think Barrett. Oh, God, if we're going of all time, fuck. That's a loaded question, bro.
I'd have to think about it.
I mean, are we talking about Canadians, too? That's not overseas. That's Canada.
Canada's not overseas,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, so, you know, you got the William Regal in there, Finley in there, you got to throw...
William Regal, you throw up there as the greatest of all time?
I say, if you're throwing in the conversation, yeah. Right. Fuck, if you're throwing, what was his other one besides Davey Boy? Barrett?
Wait, Barrett, right.
That's not
well,
even...
he says he thinks how Barrett will get there.
Oh, eventually. Okay. Well, if we're talking about who will get there, I mean, you got Sheamus, Prince, Devitt. Is Hideo Itami considered overseas?
In Mexico, Japan? Yeah, it's not... Japan, my bad.
I screwed up with Canada overseas. But, yeah, all right, so there's a bunch of guys. I mean, fuck, their whole next generation, which whatever happened to that, they teased it last week, nothing. This week, nothing.
Wait a minute. Kenta... It's Japan.
Yeah.
You said Mexico.
No, I didn't.
You just said Mexico.
You said Mexico.
I said Japan, you said Mexico.
I...
Am I wrong?
You just got it backwards.
Okay.
You said, right. Yeah, Kenta, Mexico. I said, no, not me.
Oh,
yeah,
all right. All right. Yeah, Japan. Yeah. I'm thinking, did you just say Mexico for Kenta? Mm-hmm. All right, my bad. All right. Too many tonight, guys.
Well, we're getting to the end. All right. Don't worry.
David Hadley, are you digging Sandow as the Miz's stunt double? I mean, poor Sandow.
Where are we?
Bro.
You skipped a bunch. I don't know where we are.
I didn't. We were up here.
We didn't read that one or that one. Jesus Christ.
Woo! David Hadley, that would be Andre the Giant always responding
to Ali.
Okay.
Adair, yeah.
Vincent Nugent, did you guys watch Bellator 126, Legacy FC 35, and Titan FC 30?
No.
I didn't watch any of them, man.
Along with UFC 178, yes.
Talk about UFC 178.
Yeah, Conor McGregor is a fucking superstar in the making. Apparently 10% of the ticket sales in Vegas were all from Ireland citizens, Irish citizens.
Okay. And they're doing a cruise against
Dillashaw.
Correct. They're not doing.
They're doing
Faber Feud.
Catanzaro and Ronda Rousey.
Talk about
they're
that.
They're doing. There was a bunch of title fights made and Conor McGregor is going to be front row for Chad Mendes Jose Aldo in Brazil. So they're kind of setting him up for the winner to be like calling him out when he's in the crowd and stuff.
All right.
So the bunch of title fights got set up on Saturday.
David Hadley, we'll go back to this one. Are you digging the Miz Sandow feud?
No. Not at all. He says the stunt double stuff. No.
Yeah.
I fucking hate it. I think Damian Sandow's capable of way more than being the Miz is lackey of all people.
This poor guy,
which
man.
Which brings up
Sandow,
the question.
Poor guy.
We're talking about the Miz and his lackey. Not that Ric Flair would have been his lackey, but what happened to Ric Flair making a regular return to TV as a regular character?
I don't think they have anything for him.
Supposed to be
him,
Ziggler,
man.
Or he wanted Ziggler, but it was supposed to be Miz.
I don't think they have anything for him, man.
I think they're waiting for Charlotte to get called up, and then he's going
to... Yeah, that would make sense. That would make a lot of sense, to be honest with you.
Brandon Scott Brown says, how long do you think it will take before Triple H will get full control and Vince steps down? As in years, I think the product will get so much better when that eventually happens.
I think that when Triple H takes over, I agree with you 100%. When Triple H takes over, and I've heard conference calls recently with Triple H, and I know that he probably puts on a front when he puts on these conference calls.
He's a
good
public speaker.
Acting. He's a very good public speaker. But I also feel that Triple H is way more, much more with the times than Vince McMahon. And I think, my honest opinion, and you may disagree, and this is a whole debate that you and I can get into, and we'll make it quick, and just do a one-liner. When Triple H takes over, WWE gets better.
I gotta do a little more one-liner.
All right.
He didn't see anything.
And one last thing before you go, Vince McMahon will be...
He'll be in control until he's dead.
Until he's dead. Yes.
But and I got to point out that it's not when these guys first came in and, I didn't see anything. Who did? It's while they were getting way over like Rovers. CM Punk, he didn't see it. Daniel Bryan, he didn't see it. And he tried to fight both of them when it was so clearly obvious.
Talking about Triple H.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That kind of shit scares me. If it's that obvious and you want to find an excuse not to do it because you don't agree with it, who cares what you agree with if the fans are fucking so clearly, obviously telling you CM Punk's our guy. But and after that, Daniel Bryan's our guy. Why fight it if it's so obvious that this is what they want?
You also know that Triple H is about to do a Reddit Q&A session AMA with the internet whatever, fans. Yeah. He's about to reach out to the internet fans.
He's a good politician.
He's also been putting up photos of Kevin Steen, Prince Divot, saying these guys are the future. He respects that. But
he knows that's the internet darlings. He's and catering to the community. He's catering to the media. He caters to the reporters.
Right.
Because you know,
What is a great politician, like a mayor
or a senator or a president? They know exactly.
He makes himself look so good to the public.
They will say
to the fans.
They will say what they want to hear. Yes. But meanwhile, even though he's saying this
behind the scenes,
he ain't doing that.
Absolutely,
he'll say it because he knows that's what they want to hear. But he ain't doing it, and he disagrees with it, even though he's saying it.
I still think that he is more with the times right now than Vince.
I mean, he's a generation ahead of Vince, but they're both behind the times.
I still think when Vince winds down, Triple H takes over, I think WWE.
But it's more than just creative.
I know it is. I know.
WWE's a business, very complex business, and he's got to be able to do. Vince wears 20 hats. He heads up merchandise. He heads up their corporate. Can Triple H do all of those things?
He might be
more with the times as far as their creative direction, but is he with the times as far as knowing how to do this part of the business? That has nothing to do with what we see
Triple
on TV.
Triple H is in charge of the NXT events these days.
He's in charge of creative.
He's in charge of NXT events these days. Every NXT event I have seen amazing.
Yeah.
And granted, he's only got to book these shows every 3 or 4 months, okay? So it's one show
Vince
McMahon's got to book and everything else week to week with a creative staff. I just believe that if Vince was to take over and Triple H was to take over, I would say the better product, you were to put Vince here, Triple H here, and for the next 6 months, Vince books, Triple H books, Triple H has got the better Raw and SmackDown every week.
Well, neither one of them book. They have a creative team that books, and then they kind of touch little things here and
Triple
there.
Triple H would be the better show.
If you're going off NXT, that's not fair because look at the talent.
NXT. I'm talking Raw and SmackDown.
But you're basing your opinion on Triple H's booking style based on the NXT shows he's put on, even though they're every often. But look, if you throw in Kevin Steen, Prince Devitt, Kenta, Adrian Neville, Sami Zayn, it doesn't matter who you put them in with, the matches are going to be great. Have you seen storylines that controlled in NXT? There aren't any.
For the next six
Not
months.
Really.
Let me just say this. For the next 6 months, Vince, Triple H, okay? And this is not going to happen. Vince, Triple H. Vince, you book Raw on SmackDown. Triple H,
but what are you basing that on?
I'm just basing on fantasy. On fantasy.
In your own head that you think...
In my own head, if tomorrow we were to wake up and...
Well, I can't say because I don't know.
If tomorrow we were to wake up and Vince books Raw and Triple H books SmackDown.
But they have the same talent?
And
they're working with the same writers?
Whatever it is right now. Whoever's on Raw right now and whoever's on SmackDown right now, which is basically both rosters.
Yeah.
If Vince is to book Raw and Triple H is to book SmackDown the way they want it to be, SmackDown's better than Raw because Triple H is in charge.
I don't know what you're basing it off of. How would you know Triple H?
I'm basing it on
what
Raw
record
and SmackDown.
Does he have to prove that
just
he was
watching
better?
The shows. When I watch Raw or SmackDown every week, I bet SmackDown would turn out to be the better show. Just because
you're not getting what I'm saying.
Triple H is in charge.
Yeah, but how do you know Triple H is better at doing that than Vince? He's never done it. So how would you know?
Well, we're gonna find out.
Why are you so sure that Triple H would be better at Vince when Triple H's not done it?
I think Triple H is more with
the times. Just based on how you hear him in interviews and I'm agreeing with you. He's got a better grasp on the
we haven't seen Triple H. We haven't seen Triple H book an entire Raw or SmackDown we haven't seen Triple H have the final say on a Raw or SmackDown. It's always been Vince with the final say. If we have Triple H, a bunch of creative writers. They write SmackDown, Triple H comes up, he approves everything, or he tweaks it. I think Triple H would have the better show than Vince would. I just think Triple H is more with the times.
That's what you're basing it on.
Triple H would be a better. I think Triple H
is more with the times.
Yes.
See, I don't know if he is or isn't because he hasn't had the chance.
I think Triple H would become a better booker than Vince McMahon. I think he's more. Triple H is with reality.
It's an impossible thing for me to say.
Triple H is with reality, and he knows the times.
How do you know that?
He knows. He's a younger guy. He's more hip. Triple H is more hip.
Yeah.
And Vince is kind of stuck in the 80s.
But they're not the ones writing the shows. They're writing them are.
Right.
And that's why they hire young writers.
But the creative team writes for Vince McMahon. And they know what they've got to write to make Vince McMahon happy. And if they had to write for Triple H, I think they would write a more hip show, a more...
They gotta stay PG,
with the times. You're right.
So how much hipper can you get if you gotta stay fucking PG? You know,
this. Listen, we could debate
this
all day.
It's impossible to say, and this was a great question.
We could debate this all day.
I wish that would have come up earlier.
We just went off for 5 minutes.
We could have just spent the entire second hour on that if we would have started with it.
I know.
That's a great topic to talk about in the future. But yeah, you know, I don't even think we should. If there's one left, we shouldn't even go to it. That's a perfect ending.
That's it. You know what? Why don't we come back next? There's no pay-per-views next week. There's nothing.
Two UFC shows.
We can run that down quick. Let's talk
about
it.
They both suck.
Let's hype that up for next week. Okay.
All right.
Vince McMahon, Triple H, booking.
I gotta say, though, you're gonna have a bigger thing to say. I can't say anything because I can't sit here and
we'll
guess.
Come up with something in the
but
next
no,
week.
But how could I can't even say because I don't know what Triple H could do. He's never done it.
I can't
it.
Either, bro.
How could I say it?
I can't either. I don't.
He might be hipper than Vince, sure, because he's younger.
That's why it's a debate. We don't know.
But how do I know that he would his hipness would translate to, that's not a good idea for wrestling. This is a good idea for Raw. Oh, that's not a good idea for a Raw show. This is a good... Like, just because he's hip doesn't mean he would know how to determine what's best for business.
I
can't believe I just said that. But, you know what I mean.
Best for business. Listen, brother.
Feedback.
I thought that was a good one tonight.
Feedback is what we need.
All right. We do need some feedback.
Yes.
You can go to...
Where?
Both of our Facebook
pages.
Where's
one of them?
Facebook.com/MattBoom. Facebook.com/ Ryan Clark WZR. We want all of your feedback tonight.
Yes,
the chat room, I apologize tonight, guys.
Something's
this
up with
the,
it.
This is the last comment that I've seen, and nobody's commented.
Yeah.
So
and there's only one guy commenting. So leave us in the
I think you guys are having the log out and log back in. As
I
the
see
chat
a lot of that
keeps
happening.
Freezing tonight.
Well, that's
so,
what I was going to say. In the feedback, let us know what the chat problem was. So if
yeah,
it's something
yeah,
we
definitely.
Can fix, we'll fix it. Well,
yeah.
There's
Well, here they come again.
All right, you never
anyways, what are you
going to
do?
Crazy
all
bastards.
Right. We will see you guys next Tuesday night, 8 to 10 Eastern time. By the way, we are going to try to switch production computers where we right. think
the
we
problem,
need...
I was going to do that tonight, but then you don't have nothing to sit here for your chat. For your wrong house.
We switch these.
Does that get pick up Wi-Fi?
Yes.
Oh, well, then I was going to do it tonight, but I didn't think they would be able to...
I wanted this test out.
No, because that computer's got to be plugged in.
No, we can set up Wi-Fi now.
No, for the battery. It's not plugged in. It doesn't work at all. All
right, then we can set up the...
So what's the plug? That plug there. This plug
that
would have
plug
to be
goes
plugged
in there.
But this would have to be plugged in over there. Would it reach?
Absolutely. Look how long this cord is. It's got to reach from that table to there.
Absolutely. I think it'll reach.
Absolutely.
Okay.
We're gonna try to switch things up where it'll be much faster starting next week. So we'll try to do a test run during the week. Until then, we will see you guys next Tuesday night, 8 to 10 Eastern time. We want your feedback. Facebook.com/MattBoomWZR. Facebook.com/RyanClarkWZR. Matt Boone!
That's me!
Ryan Clark!
That's him!
And see you next Tuesday night, 8 to 10 Eastern Time, WZR Online!
I'll come.